Supreme Viper, again, thanks for following. I want to take this opportunity to say, if you haven't followed, then totally follow. You want to make donation, help us make these tournament things more awesome and more regular, do it, please. And subscribe to Brink and myself on YouTube. We enjoy the love. You know what? It's nice.
Always.
It's nice to be friendly. It's nice to be friendly, isn't it?
Rio Max, I heard a rumor that overcharge does 12k damage to units. Truth or a lie? That is the truth. 12,000 wow. damage per overcharge. The only T3 units that can survive Percival or Brick. Those are the only ones that top out over 12,000.
Wow. Okay. We've got Drawn Baser asking, will you upload this to YouTube? Yes, this is actually going to be up on Brink's channel, even though I like did like 90% of it. Jeez, like, what the hell am I giving it to you for? No, this is going up on Brink's channel, so you'll be able to check that out probably in a day or two when we get the footage transferred and whatnot, I think. That's the plan.
I'm going to try to have it up late tomorrow, and I will have it subdivided where at the beginning you'll be able to hit the markers and I'll be separating the games out.
Sweet.
So you'll be able to hop, skip, and jump around it to any of the content that you missed. And hopefully I'll get everything up there, like I said, I'd say a day.
Wow. That's dedication right there. I'm very, very impressed with Uzling. I mean, he's been on the back foot for a long, long time. But at the same time...
He's not giving up.
He's not. He's really not. And we could still see the wind change. You never know. I mean, could these Corsairs be his foothold back into the game? I just don't know.
I do realize that there's a couple Corsairs up in the top left, but I don't understand why Coding Squirrel is not pushing on the top end of the map. All of the units are flowing to the right to engage the ACU, which he keeps failing to kill. And like I pointed out twice this game already, if you cannot for a fact kill the ACU, you should be killing strategic targets.
Yeah.
And it's just something that he's not doing. So
it's actually important to note that Uzling's Tech 3 factory is gone.
Oh.
It's destroyed. There is no more loyalists. There is no more bricks. I do not think there is any coming back from this. I think he's expanded all of his comebacks. A couple more overcharges will go down, take out some Percivals. Wow.
So much health.
He's doing really very, very well. I think he just vetted, didn't he?
He did. Oh, that was his fifth, goodness. Though. He's not going to get saved by that again.
Oh my goodness. Oh. This is crazy. Oh, look. Somebody's saying carbon-based. Hey, at Over the Potato, we can set quality in your stream now. That's kind of cool, I think.
Nice.
I've never been able to do that before. Like, I think that only happens to people that are, like, a certain size or whatever. I feel kind of
I don't know.
Privileged.
I think we topped out. I think we hit 75. Just a few minutes ago.
Yeah, we hit
so.
Like 81, man. Like, jeez, keep up. Keep with the times.
Oh.
It's going crazy.
I think it's frozen, that's why.
Oh, man. This is not looking very, 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 very good for Uzling at all.
He's still trying, though. He's in it to win it.
Oh, dude, he totally is.
He's hiding behind a rock at the moment.
Honestly, I don't really blame him, to be honest. Why is he putting down a tech 1 point defense? That was literally a waste of mass and literally a waste of time and everything.
Are we going to fault him for wasting mass at this point in the game? Really?
Okay. Really? No. We're not going to fault him for wasting mass because he's been doing that for the entire bloody game. Oh, my goodness. Oh. It's been a really, really crazy game. I don't understand how Uzling has managed to survive for 45 minutes. 45 minutes!
This game should have been over so long ago. So long ago.
You know what? I wouldn't have settled for a minute less of this game than it's gone on. It has been fantastic.
Five Percivals on the ACU again, but he is next to a hill. Can he run in circles around the Percivals and get away?
Oh,
overcharge.
Oh. We've got Coding Squirrel in the chat right now. Holy shit. In the chat. Live from the broadcasting room. Coding Squirrel. Oh my goodness. Okay.
I think that means we know who won.
I think we do know who wins, but in all honesty, I think we knew before he joined us in this wonderful chat. Oh, man.
Oh, sweeping in with the Interceptor is going to try to save himself again.
You know what?
Building to the very end.
This is just insane. Literally insane. Literally insane. I don't know if it could have been any more tense. I think for a semi-final, wow.
Or it definitely went back and forth enough.
Wow.
For sure.
I don't think back and forth quite explains what the heck is happening. I mean, I think back and forth and back and forth and back and forth.
I think what's happening defies explanation. Look, he's running around the rock. The group of Percivals, he's literally playing musical chairs
this is
with a swarm
amazing.
Of Percivals.
This is literally amazing.
All right, this... split in half, three on one side, three on the other, and kill the freaking commander.
Wow. Wow.
Divide and conquer, I suppose. The ACU is going after the group of two.
52 kills. 54 kills. Oh my goodness. A double Percival right there.
I'll hand him this. He's making himself a royal pain in the ass.
Yeah. I mean,
as difficult to kill as he possibly can.
This is so impressive. This, wow, 56
kills.
There's
the kill shot right there.
Wow. GG.
Well, no one can accuse Usling of being a quitter. Nobody.
Wow. Wow. Oh, my goodness. What a game. What a freaking game. GG, Coding Squirrel. GG, Usling. Congratulations, Coding Squirrel. I think you've won the tournament. I think so. I'm not entirely sure. Let's go and have a look at the standings. I'm not entirely sure how this whole double elimination thing works. I'll be honest with you.
I think there's one more.
I think there's one more match.
Wait, why is Usling in the winner slot? What?
I don't know. Uh-oh. That doesn't make much sense.
I think someone misentered the data.
I think so. Let's have a look and see what's going on in the chat. The official chat. He deserves to win. What is going on? Anything? What?
I think they're discussing another match. Not this one.
Oh no. What is? I don't understand what's going on. I don't understand what's going on.
I will say that the finals is, or the semifinals was misrecorded for sure. Because it should be Coding Squirrel versus, no, that one hadn't been decided yet.
Versus one of these two? I'm not entirely sure. Oh, okay. So Coding Squirrel is going to be in the finals against somebody else here. Okay.
I am confused too. Oh, the time limit was 45 minutes.
Ah.
They went over the time limit, which if they do that, it's decided by random draw. And they're discussing in the chat foregoing the random draw and one of the players forfeiting. I don't know which one. So if they've already recorded Usling, it looks like Usling is the one that advances.
Oh, that's a real shame. That's a real shame. Wow. I suppose a creative use of tournament mechanics. Uh-oh, wait, we've got the actual tournament organizer in the chat right now. Manraid. Manraid is actually in the chat. Holy cow. All right. Apparently, Brink, you need to read the chat. People are screaming at you in the chat.
I am trying to back read, and I can't decide where the whole thing went south.
Oh, my goodness. Wow, guys. Okay, so it looks like...
That actually introduces an interesting discussion because either one of those guys at several points during that game could have won.
Like, yeah.
At the end, the clear-cut winner was Coding Squirrel, but... Yeah. At several points up till then, it looked like Usling was just going to wipe out Squirrel. So, I don't know. Random draw would be a good way to decide that since they did go over the time limit. But if one of them was going to forfeit, I don't know which one of them would because they both had valid win scenarios.
Yeah, but apparently it must have just been this whole random draw mechanic. Apologies. Oh my god, I think I just warned the tournament organizer not to post links in my chat. How embarrassing is that? That's really mortifying.
The bot is serious.
I've got the thing up on here. I just wasn't showing it.
So this apparently Usling is the one that's going to advance.
Okay. You know what? That's okay. So we've still got one more game to go.
But Coding Squirrel could win the semifinal loser round and still go to the final.
Okay. Okay.
So he is not completely out. I guess he just gave Usling the benefit of the match so that he could stay in.
Okay. You know what? That's understandable. So we're still going to see another match? Is that what you're telling me?
There's actually a couple of potential matches because on the loser bracket, they've still got two games to go.
Okay.
So we could pick up, there is Sescu versus Bot, which I think would be a pretty good game, but we've already seen one of those players. And Radio Face versus Sarah 2.
Oh my goodness. All right. Let's just take a chill pill right now. Let's take a little chill pill and see what's going on because wow. What an absolutely crazy, crazy day so far. Okay? Okay, so it seems to me that there is gonna be a final match. That is gonna be soon, but we need to go through the losers rounds first. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Oh my goodness. Like I'll be honest, like I've never ever had more than like 15 people in my chat before, and suddenly to get like 81, it's kind of insane to like try and read all the comments.
Yeah.
It's after a certain point,
I've been browsing it and trying to point out the important ones because I know you're a little bit more focused on camera controls, but yeah, it's everybody's real chatty, and this is one of the things I love about the FAF people because they're typically pretty friendly. You don't see as much just aggressive trolling as you see in some chats, so it's not quite so bad.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's really, really good. I'm very, very grateful to everybody, by the way, who's been super, super nice to me as just this random outsider to this very exclusive community. I feel that that's worth just saying. Thanks, guys. You're the best. And thanks, Brink, you know, for getting me into this in a hardcore sort of way. I mean, it's crazy.
Absolutely, man.
Oh, it's so good. All right, I'm just trying to get the chat box up on.
Uh-oh. It looks like we have unknowingly issued a challenge.
What?
The Crasher says, it sounds like they want us to chat more, entirely making it harder for them to read.
You know what? That wasn't actually what I had in mind. I'll be honest. I don't really know what I did have in mind, actually. Oh, my goodness. All right. Oh, it's crazy. It's really, really crazy. So we need to watch some of these loser rounds progress, and then Coding Squirrel is going to be up against somebody, and if he beats them, he will be once again in the finals with Usling. How crazy would that be? How crazy?
Might get to see the ultimate rematch.
Yeah, I think so.
All right, so who do we want to hit up? We've got, like I said, the two current rounds are Radio Face and Sarah 2, which should be pretty decent players, and then Sescu and Bot, who are also pretty good, over the 1,000 global rank, I believe. So either one of those would be fine. We've already seen Sescu.
We have seen Sescu, so do you think that that Radio Face and Sarah 2 would be a good option?
Looks like we've got at least two people in chat saying they want to see Radio. So
Radio. Oh, you know
yes.
What? If anybody wants to see a specific game, let us know because, you know, your wish is my command. Absolutely. Okay. I'm trying to patch together this stream. I'm trying to add an alert box and a chat box to the standings page.
Well, you take care of that. I'm going to bow out for about 45 seconds. I'll be right back. I got to adjust something.
All right. Now is our opportunity. Now's our opportunity to to spill the beans on Brink, you know, what do you think of him? How much of a dodgy dude is he? I mean, he's a pretty dodgy dude, isn't he? I mean, jeez. Jeez Louise. He's a pretty dodgy guy, I'll be honest. Not too fond of him myself, but hey ho. Hey ho. Alright, I'm just trying to patch together an alert box here. An alert box. Patching that together. Alright. Great. We should have an alert box right now. Yeah, Brink is absolutely awesome. I'm joking, by the way. He's a totally legitimately cool dude. Oh man. Okay, great. We've patched that together. So if anybody else wants to follow, then totally do that. Subscribe to me on YouTube. Subscribe to Brink on the thingamajigger, the YouTube too. People are commenting in Alias, the main chat of Supcom, saying Orbital do Sarah too. Okay, well, you know what? We'll consider of it. We'll consider it for sure. If you guys want to see that, then totally let us know. Also, if you want to make a donation, which would be super, super awesome, me and Brink take a 50% share of this. If you want to get your name up on the screen, if you want to help make these streams more regular, if you want to help make these tournament castings more regular, because I've enjoyed it, Brink's enjoyed it, and if you want to help us, then that would be totally, totally, totally awesome. So if you want to do it, then do it, and I'll think that you're a legend forever. I think I hear that Brink may be back, although...
I am back, just didn't want to interrupt you.
That's great, that's great. You know what, that's awesome. Feel free to interrupt anytime you want. All right.
We know which game we're launching, and are we ready?
I think we're going to go for the Sarah 2 one, which is to say the first of two games that are currently being played right now. All right, that's not where to go. I need to go into here, and we need to click on there. Okay, great. Yeah. All right.
You know, when I saw the time limits on the tournament matches, I really did not think I would see any of them hit the time limit.
No, I agree with that. I agree with that. All right. So here we go. We've got Radio Face up in the top northern area. Apologies, my words seem to be losing more and more cohesion as the night goes on. I think that's probably the correct term. And Sarah too. Down in the bottom. Brink, have you ever seen any of these guys play before? If so, what do you think?
I have been in a couple of games with Sarah 2, if I'm not totally mistaken, but I don't remember anything. So that could be great because I don't remember anything bad, and it could also be terrible because I don't know. It's just neutral feelings. So Judging by the ranks, though, these guys should be competent. We got 1300 and 1200, which is right around the average skill level on the FA client. So these guys should know their business and be able to get around the map pretty well.
If you had to make some sort of a prediction, you know, let's say, who would you pin your hopes and dreams on?
Well, I broke down the other one by faction. Let's take a look at this one. UEF, like I said before, they have a solid T1 through T3 with an exceptionally strong T3 stage.
Okay.
Seraphim, on the other hand, has an equal T1 force to UEF. It's going to be tit for tat. Nobody has an advantage on that one. But Seraphim T2 is incredibly strong. We're probably going to see early T2 from Sarah 2. And then that's going to be hard for Radio Face to block. However, once again, if the UEF player can survive the T2 stage, the Seraphim T3 sucks. So UEF is just going to stomp all over the face of Seraphim once they hit the T3 stage, even worse than what we just saw, exponentially worse.
Okay, so who are you going for? Who do you think it's going to be?
Let's cheer for the underdog. I'm going to go for Sarah.
Okay, you know what? I can appreciate that mentality. Anything really interesting happening? I'm not gonna lie. I think it's pretty standard opening sort of setup, isn't it? It's not really that crazy, is it?
No, pretty standard. You're going to see land factories going down. We got second air, but you'll notice that he's laying down three power generators in addition to the hydro, so we won't see any of that nasty power stall coming from the north side like we did last time. So kudos to him for actually building enough power.
That is very, very good. That's very, very good. And, you know, if we were to see sort of an air build, what would we expect to see and when would we expect to see it from both of the players?
If you were doing an early air build?
If we were doing any air build at all, what is the build that's going to be most successful? When is it going to be implemented by these two players?
I think your best bet is going to be a bomber out very, very early to try to snipe off any of the outlying engineers, which is a pretty common tactic. We're probably going to see that from at least one of these guys. Actually, it looks like Sarah already has an air scout out. So he has beaten Radio Face to the air game, and he's building an interceptor to counter the bomber that he assumes is coming from the other side. So nice little defensive move there, and then probably around 7 or 8 minutes or sooner, I would have an air transport and be dropping off some units around the edges of the map to try to pick up some mass extractors.
So already we can see that Sarah is engaging in the war of intelligence rather than the war of firepower. You know, he's making sure that he's grabbing a nice healthy chunk of what the hell is going on. And he's good at that, you know. He seems to have gotten the message early. I mean, more so than Radio Face, who still has relatively little idea, even though he's got an air scout.
The amount of symmetrical play here is kind of astounding. You've got a tank and a scout meeting a tank and a scout in the middle. Both players have an extra scout. Then you've got the air scout followed by interceptor, and I think followed by bomber if Radio Face follows through on the air build. So they're doing exactly the same thing, which means they've probably discovered the meta for the map, and it's going to come down to execution and what happens a few minutes later on in this game.
You know what? Okay, I'm down with that. I'm down with that. I mean, we're seeing, once again, you know, the standard sort of stream some enemies. We do see a bomber coming out of Radio Face. I didn't expect him to have... Well, he didn't have the first bomber, did he? No, Sarah did. Nope. Okay.
There's actually two bombers out for Sarah.
Indeed, there is.
He's got another one down hanging around the south end, so...
So, that engineer's going to go down. Bye, buddy. And how many engineers do bombers have to kill to make their mass back? Is it? I can't really recall.
Two.
Oh, it's of course it's two.
You're messing with me. we were joking about this the other day. Apparently, I say that way too much in my cast.
I don't think you say that way too much. I think it's become a pillar of who you are, man. It's
enough. I say it enough that it is a firm component in the cast, and everyone knows it. But hey, as long as you remember that, you'll know whether you're throwing away your bombers uselessly or not. So
that's a
useful piece of information.
It's a good point. It's a very, very good point. You are the pillar for the Supreme Commander community, and you're lecturing them about efficiency. I approve of that. We've actually got Zoc in the chat saying Radio Phase has the power of Zoc lessons. So
take his second two are funnier. Take lessons to win tourney, to win more lessons, to win the next turn.
That's great. I love that. That's
fantastic.
For those
of you who don't know, this is technically a noob tourney, even though some of the guys are, you know, more up in the average Joe's ranking. It's towards the not necessarily people who play this game constantly or are exceptionally good at it. And part of the prize for it is lessons from Zockyzock, who is an exceptionally good pro ladder player. So whoever wins this tournament is going to get some sit-down time with him, a couple of personal lessons, going over some replays, some gameplay, that kind of thing. And that is great help towards improving. So,
well, that's great. That is really good. I mean, I did find a comment earlier that said, well, should Zockyzock not be giving lessons to the losers? Is that not something? And I thought, well, you know what? That's actually a really good point. But at the same
that
time,
is.
That defeats the whole incentive
you're
to actually try and win.
The best of the playing pool and giving them lessons to get better.
Yeah, I thought it was hilarious. I thought it was really good. All right, so we've got a massive amount of units that are moving forward for Radio Face. But Sarah also has a rather significant amount of units that are moving forward at a similar rate. So I think they're probably just going to clash in the middle and just go nowhere, like they've done pretty much all game, I think.
Yeah, to me, it looks like Sarah and Radio Face are executing the exact same build.
It's creepy.
And Sarah is two steps ahead. He's already cleared his three mechs expansion. He's gotten the reclaim. He's moving to the left. He's got more units on the table. And let's see, he's got five land factories down. How many does the North have? Four?
One, two, three, four, five. Indeed, he does. Up in the North. Oh,
six.
My goodness.
Ah, lots of production coming online.
Lots and lots of production. However,
it's an identical amount. They've
however,
got
not enough mass to do anything
going
with it.
Down up there.
Not enough mass to do anything with it, which is a real shame, and it looks like that bomber could potentially score big. Getting two
or
engineers.
That
or that one. That one too. you know what, Brink? I'll tell you a fun fact, right? So that bomber has actually made its worth in mass back because it's actually killed two engineers. Did you know that?
I did, actually.
Did you really?
I did happen to know that little factoid.
Oh my goodness. All right, I'm so
never
sorry.
Never going to live that one down, never ever. I would love to see some power generators being attacked by those bombers, because since there's two bombers and a lot of power generators packed in close together, a couple of bombs on each one, and you should be able to take those down pretty easily. I would say going after the Hydro is a very bad idea, because the health on that's going to let it survive.
Yep.
So.
And the anti-air, the mobile anti-air, will just whittle down these bombers, you know, even though they're not doing a substantial amount of damage per turn. A couple of barrages onto that bomber, and it's going to be dead.
Yep. We could probably bump this game up to maybe plus two, somewhere around in there, plus three.
That works for me, as far as I'm concerned.
Because this game probably was 2/3 over, judging by the time it was launched. So
I can well believe that, and you know I think it's it's fair to say that not much progress is being made by either player at this moment in time. I think. Probably Sarah is doing a little bit better of a harassment game, I would say that's fair to say. But that harassment is getting shut down fairly hard by the fact that these mobile anti-air guns are rolling out.
We do have some nice tank harassment from Radio Face. You can see the left of center expansion was just wiped out by a couple of tanks that engineer picked off. And overall, there's a lot of tanks in some weird places. You can see the left expansions. There's four mass extractors down from tanks that were rammed into the back.
Yeah.
So while Sarah is making progress in air, I think Radio Face is doing a much better job of getting his land units where they need to be. Although that push up the middle is looking a little bit nasty at the moment.
All right. People are complaining about the minimap. Is that better for everybody? Is that better for the minimap sort of things? I hope it is. I've
it
tried.
Should.
Okay. Wow. I can't believe it. I really can't believe it. The fact that we've got Zoc and Manreed in the chat. The chat of a person that can actually barely play Supreme Commander. I feel humbled right now. Not even
well,
kidding.
this is basically the official tourney coverage, so
the official tourney coverage! Yes, that's right. Damn yes, I'm down with that. Oh,
off
man.
To the right, we got some units splitting off down there, but I don't think a lot of progress is going to be made because the ACU is once again coming down the right side.
Yeah.
There's a point defense there that's going to kind of stall it a little bit, but this is looking like somewhat of a stalemate to me.
If this ACU runs up against this point defense, then it could prove to be a little bit dicey.
If he has an overcharge in his pocket, he should be able to knock it out fairly easily.
Perhaps he does not, but the game has paused.
The game must be over.
Really? Seriously?
It probably just ended, which broke the replay.
It definitely just ended. Radio Face won it. Congratulations, Radio Face.
So they were right. The power of Zocky Zoc.
The power of Zocky Zoc. Wow. What? Isn't like he was able to hack the game or something? Is that it?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
Maybe. Well, let's go to the standings. Let's have a little look about what's going on. Also, Zocky Zoc is harassing the hell out of me. for not managing to organize my screen capture in the appropriate manner. To that I say, I'm sorry, I really am, but we tried to do something with screen sharing and it didn't really work out. That's why it's in windowed mode, and that's why you can see some stuff behind it. But hey ho. All right, people are messaging me on FAF or something. All right. Apparently, we're being told to do the losers round 5, the other match. Is that something that you'd be up for? I mean, we can just
if we're okay with seeing the same map back to back 3 times. That would be my only reservation on that one.
That is a good point, actually, isn't it?
Because if we move on to round 6, we get to see a different map.
All right. Well, round 6 is between Phelim and Radioface. Has it started yet? I'm not entirely sure.
If it has, nope. So it looks like we've got a few minutes of downtime.
Okay, that's fine. Then we can just chat and read through the chat, to be honest. It's like whenever I'm not talking to you, it's like I'm frantically scrambling to read what the heck is going on in the chat. It's
sometimes
crazy.
It's better just not to keep up with it because a large portion of it is ribbing. It's not to be taken too seriously. So
you know what? It gives me like the inspiration for all of my jokes. Like I'm not even kidding you. I mean, like this one by Nijlas. I'm quite shocked. Does FAF really have as many as 80 viewers? I didn't know, but I think that's, you know, that's a potential joke to be made about the popularity of a 10-year-old game or whatever it is. So
this is actually a pretty high amount for what we typically get. I think the last time that there was a fairly significant portion of a tournament like this casted, it capped at like 50-something.
Well,
so
dude,
we're beating records.
I think we're making history right now. Science Potato is now following. I approve of the name, friend.
Is Science Potato the one that drew up the designs for you to get in orbit?
I don't comment on issues of national security, actually.
I sense a conspiracy.
Lovely weather today. Lovely weather today.
Confirmed. The potatoes were the first ones to
move. Oh, man. Man. All right. Zocky Zock saying I had 150 as a maximum. All right. You know what? There's no need to brag. There's no need to make me feel bad about myself. This is kind of like the first, I don't know, dual casted stream that we've ever done before, isn't it? This is the first thing.
This is the first one.
It's crazy.
So, yep.
Oh, man.
Blodeer mentioning we had about 100 when the faffening happened. Well, that was a cataclysmic event, so I think we can probably take exception for that one, because that
faffening
doesn't happen every day.
The faffening? What the heck was a faffening?
I believe he is referring to the day that the FAF server died.
Oh!
It was a very brief death. It came back very, very quickly, but it was kind of a heart-rending set of circumstances for those of us who hang out in this community, and so everybody was trying to get news on it. So.
Oh man. Zocky Zock saying, no, you are great, and, you know, If you compliment me, I'm more likely to read out the comment that you're making, just FYI. And if you insult Brink as well, if you compliment me and you insult Brink, then you've got a doubly likely chance that I will read out your comment. Just putting it out there.
That's the case, then I get to read potato insults. So,
yes, yes, totally. All right,
it'd be like reading mean tweets.
yeah, except we're not celebrities and... Yeah, that sort of falls apart. Anyway, Zocky Zock says, I regret not being able to have been able to watch this since the start. Well, Brink, where will everybody be able to find out about this fantastic video and what has happened in the ensuing days?
On the YouTube channel, youtube.com/BrinkoInsanity, spelled exactly like my screen name. Within about the next 24 hours, I'll have this posted up to YouTube, and it will actually be subdivided into all of the different matches. So you'll be able to start that video, hit the link, and go to the correct minute where the videos start. And if you missed any of the content over the course of this cast, which I know it is a long one, Orbital Potato did, I think, judging by the time we're at, he did basically the first half by himself. At any point during this cast, you can just hop, skip, and jump to it and see anything that you missed.
Sweet. Yep. So definitely go and check that out when it goes up on Brink's channel, because it will definitely, definitely, definitely be going up very, very soon. So Do you guys like this? Do you guys sort of like this format, what we're doing? I mean, I know it's only the last sort of couple of games that we've done a proper co-cast together, and the other one was just the other couple of games was just me rambling innately for like 3 hours. But do you guys like this? Do you want to see more of this stuff? Because I'm genuinely curious right now. Do you have any, you know, feedback, comments to make? Interesting.
I'd say this is enough of a good time. I'd probably do it if even half this number of people were watching.
Yeah, I think it's awesome. I think
FAF really is cool. A good time.
It is. It's a great time. All right, so Phelim versus Radio Face looks like it's going to be getting underway very, very shortly. And Sescu apparently completed this match. I don't understand. Don't understand how we managed to win that one, but hey-ho. Perhaps
possibly a disconnect win?
Possibly maybe something a like disconnect that. Win.
I don't know. It looks like the other guys haven't. Phelim and Radio Face have not yet launched.
No, and even if they have, we need to wait like 5 minutes anyway, so.
Yeah. Question on the stream. Why did I rename from Zap Brannigan back to Brink of Insanity? That's actually a common misconception. I was Brink of Insanity for a very long time before I was Zap Brannigan. I was Zap Brannigan for about 2 months, and then I ran into copyright issues on my YouTube channel because people are totally not cool about naming your channel after something that you don't own, and so I went back to Brink of Insanity. So, yeah.
What the heck is Zap Brannigan?
Have you never watched Futurama? The best animated show ever to have graced the face of planet Earth.
All right, I have watched it before, but I still have literally no idea what the heck that is.
Zap Brannigan is the most conceited bastard that has ever flown a spaceship, and he is hilarious. You should totally go watch some clips of him on YouTube, which have not been copyright claimed, even though my name was brought up. I don't understand.
Someone is slightly bitter, I feel, about this whole issue. Oh, man.
Uh-oh. Orbital Potato doesn't know Futurama, and he is no longer cool. I am so sorry.
I know what Futurama is.
I'm so sorry, Potato.
Don't throw me under the bus like
cold
that, dude.
Cold isn't good for potatoes anyway. You can feel better about that. You'll last longer.
Oh my goodness, that's insulting. No, I do know what Futurama is. I haven't watched that many episodes of it, I'm sorry, but I know what it is at least. And people are saying, why don't we just jump into the lobby and watch as an observer? Well, if either my internet or Brink's internet goes down, then that would have a catastrophic effect on the match, and it would probably end up crashing or whatever.
It probably wouldn't break it. Like, there's a 95% chance that everything would go perfectly smoothly, but I would greatly, greatly hate to see a tournament match ruined by one of us experiencing computer problems. So it's just not worth it.
Well, exactly, right? The thing is that, you know, we are very much an outside sort of entity. We don't come here to, you know, muck around with people's stuff. We just want to watch some awesome Supreme Commander, and, you know, the best way in our eyes to do that is to watch the game with a little 5-minute delay. It doesn't take away at all from, you know, how interesting the matches are, so.
After all, you get to hear us ramble on for 10 minutes, so how can that possibly be a detriment?
That's totally great. I mean, that's totally awesome. Right. Okay.
Have they? Oh, they have launched.
They have.
I'm looking at the screen with the crosses, and I'm asking whether they've launched or not.
Yeah, no, that's understandable.
Hip, hip, hooray for situational awareness.
So this is going to be the losers round six. Just heading back here for a second. Losers round six is underway, and losers round seven will be the one after this one. And Coding Squirrel, who's actually in the chat right now, saying some stuff that just goes past way too quickly. Coding Squirrel is going to be up against the winner of Losers Round 7. Oh man, this tournament just can't get any better. It's so good. So damn good. Like, for a first tournament, I'm being like blown away. Like, they can't all be as interesting this as this one, can they? Like, are they Are they this good?
It just depends. This one is actually the second tournament hosted by Manreid, and typically the first experience is not so good because you're frantically running around like a chicken with your head cut off and you can't figure out what to do and when to do it, and it's just a disorganized mess. So we have the benefit of an experienced tournament director on this one, and it is going exceptionally well. I rarely see one that goes this smoothly, so can't claim any of the credit for that one, but it is fantastic to watch it going forward.
Man, how fantastic. How fantastic. And hopefully, in the future, I think that there is a strong chance that I think there's one of two things that could happen. We could see, you know, more tournaments happening and, you know, larger tournaments happening, you know, lots more people competing in tournaments, which I think is epic. And I also think, don't quote me on this, right? But there could potentially be like a prize pool involved if I can manage to get some sponsorship for this cast. That is a possibility.
Well,
like, genuinely,
there is actually multiple money tournaments going on already. Wow. The prize pool for this one is actually $200. In addition to the Zach lessons. And then rumor has it, actually not even rumor, it is confirmed, but I don't know when it is happening. There is a $15,000 tournament.
That is going to
be happening at some point in the next 12 months with FAF, and that is going to be hosted by Vijonic, the owner of the server for this client. So I don't know when it's happening. He has not set forth any specific plans, but he has confirmed that it will be happening. So we might be able to see a ton of action at that time.
And would this just be like a massive everybody can do it sort of tournament, or is it like
lots of brackets? Yeah, it's going to separate everybody out into fair competition.
Yeah.
But it's going to be pretty much anybody in the community will have some way to compete. So,
dude.
Yeah. Holy Zlow cow. Pointing out also there is currently a $400 survival challenge being hosted.
Wow.
So
wow, this is epic. This is so good. We need to get on that, man. We need to be co-cast in that.
This is the experiment. This is the experiment, and it's gone really, really well, except for the fact that Mother Nature threw a tree at me. So I think if we can stay away from that from here on out, we should be able to do this tournament cast as a fairly regular thing.
Oh man. Oh, it's been such good fun. I hope everybody else has enjoyed it as much as at least I have, and I can't speak for you, but...
Is that a match launching?
Maybe. I don't know. I don't comment on speculation.
My goodness, it's been so long.
Oh my goodness. This is a whopper of a match. Wow.
Yes. This is a 20K.
20K. Yeah, it's a 20K.
And Roanoke Abyss.
And Radio Face up in the north side. North side? Up in the north side. Up in the north side. And Phelim down in the south side. Who are you pinning your hopes on in this match, Mr. Insanity?
Radio Face is obviously the more experienced one, but I gotta root for Cybern because I just love Cybern as a faction, and they have stupidly strong T2 Navy. So if he can get T2 Navy in the water and make good use of that, I think that he can mop up in the T2 phase, but we'll just have to see how everything plays out.
Yeah, yeah, totally, absolutely. So you think that naval warfare is going to be key to defining who wins this match?
Yes, because both factions' destroyers can reach the entirety of all of the land masses. So whoever controls the water is going to control the map. And usually on a map this big, you're going to say whoever controls the air is going to control the map. And while to a certain extent that is true, Navy controls better than air does because naval anti-air can wipe out large numbers of air units very, very quickly. So basically you're going to be wanting to get a buttload of frigates online as soon as you possibly can. You're going to use them basically like T1 tanks to set up your map control, and then you're going to be wanting to shift to T2 for the cruisers for anti-air and the destroyers for distance warfare, and just try your level best to gain as much map control as you can, because you can see how the mexes are scattered out.
Yeah.
You've got to control the island to control the mexes.
Yeah, what I, you know, when I've personally played this map, somebody made a comment, by the way, and said, how can you not go insane while playing this map. I hate this map. I will be quite frankly honest. This map is a nightmare, especially for somebody with as little experience as I am. And I'm not entirely sure if the, you know, these guys have practiced this map. We don't really know how much they've played it. But certainly, if they come across some of the obstacles that I have come across playing this map, then yeah, you know, it's a difficult one for sure. You know, the amount of micromanaging of aircraft between islands was certainly something that I really struggled with. And there is just a lot of space with a lot of stuff to go on.
Yeah. If you zoom in on the home islands, either one of them, you can see there's actually a large amount of reclaim on these, which is going to give you that boost in mass that you need to get your boats in the water, and you're going to want early air transport. You can see we're actually going second and third, double air factory right off the bat to try to get that air control. Those gray splotches on the island have lots and lots of little rocks on them that have tons of reclaim. So that's how you're going to get your initial boost.
Well, in fact, there we go. Okay. Some rocky reclaim, 110 mass from that rock over there. And I think our competitor in the north has already taken advantage of that rock that was up there. Great.
There's a bunch of them. I don't think that screen was actually catching all of them that were available. You can see all those little gray dots laying around. Those are all reclaimable.
I'm pressing control and shift, and it just...
Maybe they're too small for it to recognize.
Maybe
I don't know.
They are. I do not know. I do not know. Oh, man. I'm really, really excited for this game, actually, because it's been a while, you know, tonight, since we've seen a game that was so focused around, you know, the Navy or the naval aspect of... you know, of FAF, of Forged Alliance, you know? So I think Naval is going to be awesome.
There was the Bermuda Locket earlier, which I wasn't actually around for that game, but you said it was decided by a T2 shift in the Navy. I think that's going to be a similar story here.
That was actually one of my most favorite games. That was a game between Coding and... What's the guy from New Zealand? I keep on forgetting his name.
Sesku,
indeed it was. So it was fairly clear that from the early game, Sesku was going, you know, heavily after Naval. and Coding was going, you know, fairly heavily after land units. But as this progressed, Speed 2, thank you very much for following. As this progressed, you know, Coding clearly realized that a transition into Tier 2 Navy would render his opponent completely useless. And all of those ships that Cessna had built up were going to be worthless. So I think, without a doubt, Naval, and specifically the Tier 2 shift, is going to be very, very interesting in this game, and I think that's going to help define what the hell actually happens.
Definitely. This is a 45-minute time limit, correct?
I think indeed it is, although it may have been adjusted.
If it were open to any time limit, eventually the UEF T3 Navy overpowers pretty much everything else going on. But since there's that 45-minute cap, it's going to encourage players to stay in the T2 phase longer and try to end the game earlier, which is where Cybern is stronger. So I think we're probably going to see a massive engagement of frigates, plenty of T2, and I would bet money on the fact that Radio Face is going to try for a battle cruiser if this game goes past 30 minutes. So we might actually see some T3 Navy just for sake of the fact that UEF has to push for T3 to keep up with Cybern T2.
I think that is a fair analysis. I just want to point out it is an hour time limit. That's how long it
an
is.
An hour. We'll definitely see upped. T3 Navy if this goes past 30 minutes.
Oh, man. Tier 3 Navy. I don't think I've ever seen Tier 3 Navy before. Like, genuinely.
Battleships.
I've never seen Tier 3 Navy before.
So, battleships everywhere.
You know what? I think that really sort of flashes my credentials of how little I can actually comment on what the hell is going on right now. If I've never even seen Tech 3 Navy. Crazy.
Well, see, there's actually a pattern to the games we've been playing, and some of you might have picked up on it if you've been watching the games that Potato and I have been playing on our YouTube channels. I have actually been getting you used to 5K maps, smaller stuff, so that you get the early builds down, which are incredibly important. And then we're going to be starting to play Monday's game is kind of hilarious. You're just going to have to see what's released on that one. It's just oddball. But for the next one, I want to try to pick a bigger map so that we can actually start trying to use some of these larger units, the higher tech levels, and it's going to be awesome. But T3 Navy is a blast. I can say that.
Like, as you progress up the tiers, the units just get more and more fun. Like, that.
It's truly an epic scale strategy game. I mean, everything is huge.
Okay, so Zoc is actually pointing out, yeah, Phelim is being very, very greedy. This is a very, very advanced position. However, he can afford to do that because it's his ACU that is actually being pathed towards this island. So, without a shadow of a doubt, he should probably put some defenses down there. I don't think he's going to manage to repel the ACU from this island.
No, he could put some mass into a couple of T1 point defense, but I think that would just be stalling and really a waste.
Yeah.
Although sitting there idle with those engineers is not really a good idea either.
Indeed. Okay, I've got a couple of people to thank for following. Bobix Boxa. I have no idea how to say that, I'll be honest with you. Zocky Zoc, thanks for following. Appreciate it, man. I mean, thanks for organizing this fantastic tournament in along with Manreed. It's awesome. It's epic. It's great. We're loving it. And Bloodair, thank you very much. Ooh. Everybody.
Transport coming in from Radiohead.
Transport coming in.
That's
what is
going
it
to swing the build power in favor of Radio Face.
That is.
Did I just call him Radiohead?
I think that's a band, isn't it?
It is. I just call him Radiohead.
You know what? I think that's a compliment.
All right. So,
Finstas, thanks very much for following. All of you guys, all of you lovely, lovely people who are actually following, it's making it very, very difficult to actually comment on what's going on. I mean, maybe that's what people are trying to do. Maybe they're just trying to follow me so much that they're just trying to shut me up. Like, genuinely, like, you messer.
Could be the case.
Thank you for following. Like, Maybe they are. Absolute Despair is now following. Wow, that probably
I think they're now messing
at my
with
voice.
You officially.
if messing with me involves me getting more followers, then please mess with me all the time. Like, that is... ProLabs is now following.
Oh my goodness. Someone messaging in the chat. Best nickname here for some time now. In FAF chat, there is a person named... Algna ask did you get a connection? Whatever. It's like 28 characters long random alpha. It's like
that's ridiculous.
I hope that I don't have to cast a game with him in it because I think my tongue would climb out of my mouth and beat me for trying to make it pronounce that.
Oh man, and while you've been talking, two people have actually followed. So Bomboy221 and Mad Mozart, thanks for following. I appreciate it. ACU will be engaging engineers. Okay.
Oh, Control
Whoa.
K. Wow.
Whoa. Wow.
Gonna Why? Deny that tech, I think, is the main reason behind that. Okay. Because you can capture factories and units in FA. So if he left those factories online, inevitably Radio Face would have captured one of the factories, and then he would have Cybern and UEF tech.
Ooh.
So that is why he Control K'd all those factories.
Theoretically, though, an engineer could still be captured that would result in a similar sort of situation. Is that not the case?
It could, but if you're watching it, you can reclaim the factories you just Control K'd until you see the ACU actually start capturing the engineer and then kill it.
Ah, okay.
So he's just trying to get the best bang for his buck out of his stay on that island and then bail out at the last possible second.
You know what? That while that may seem a little bit weird, I think that probably distracted Radio Face, you know, a little bit for a certain length of time trying to clean up that sort of mess over there. So it may not have gone to waste. You never know.
Well,
never know.
I'd say Radio Face is still substantially ahead on expansion. He is pulling in Well, it says 100, but I think that is warped due to reclaim. Looks like 70-ish mass per tick versus 40-ish. Okay. Oh, power stall. That is nasty business
very
there.
Big. Very big, powerful. By the way, just two more people to shout out for following. 1001 is now following. Thank you very much. And AULEX. And in addition to Fruitcake Elemental, who just followed right there. So please actually stop following, because I want to maintain some sort of a cohesive sentence structure with Brink. Please, just be chill. Just be chill. It's all good. All right. So anyway, we've not seen any particular player advance beyond the halfway line specifically, have we? I mean, it's fairly even for now, although...
Yep. There's a group of frigates coming.
Exactly. That's what I was waiting to say. There's a group of frigates that are just advancing slowly but surely, and they're going to definitely try and take a chunk out of Phelim.
I think Phelim is actually going in the really wrong direction with his navy. He's building T1 subs, which, from a logical standpoint, you could say, oh, T1 subs are perfect because they can damage frigates with their torpedoes, and frigates cannot damage subs. The problem is that it takes a sub a long time to chew through the massive amount of health that frigates have. And by the time the subs start killing the frigates, then the frigate's already done the damage that it's going to do. And then the frigate offers you the advantage of being able to attack engineers on the surface or on the shore. And it also has anti-air. So going 100% sub spam to me seems like a huge mistake, and Phelim is already 5 subs deep into this.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, he is going to get a frigate for his troubles. You know, let's be frank. But is
long-term,
it
it's not a good plan.
Oh, crazy. Crazy. By the way, we just got a donation. We got a donation.
What?
I know, right? Zoxix. All right, Zoxix. Thank you very much for the £15 donation. That is epic. That is definitely going to ensure that we are going to do this in the future. For sure. Oh, man. It's going great. It's going great. What a fantastic way to start off our tournament casting careers, man. How crazy is that?
Yep. Uh-oh. More to follow, for Uh-oh. Sure. Actually, somebody jumping in, BC Blackheart, new caster... apparently he has not heard you before. This oh. is Orbital Potato, someone who recently discovered FAF.
Yeah, you talk about it like it's like a religion. It's like, oh,
it is
discovered.
You have only just stepped in. <I'm> just kidding. Please don't run away. We promise we won't hurt you.
Oh man, it's fantastic. Okay, so a cheeky little Tech 1 engineer here. Right, this could be quite a pickup if he could. Manage to capture this radar system. That would be pretty impressive, actually.
Or he could just sit there and chill in the forest. I mean,
totally
in the
legitimate.
Cool of the trees, hanging out in the shade.
Oh,
just
that's totally awesome. Yeah,
laxing off of life.
Well, he did actually just come off a seriously long plane journey. So I suppose he's due a little time in the business lounge or whatever. You know.
Yep. Man, still 100% sub spam.
Yeah.
From Phelim. This is going to end up putting him in a world of hurt, because I guarantee you that Radio Face is going to drop T2 on a factory and throw out 2 Coopers and a shield, and he is going to completely and totally eliminate Phelim's entire navy with 3 units. That's just what's going to happen.
Wow.
Let's bank on it. Take bets.
what's also worrying is that he's moving these attack submarines away from his naval factories, which I imagine the frigates will try and target down. He's bringing
yes.
them back now, but if he moves too many of them away, then that could be fairly bad. Zoxix, good night. You just said goodbye. You donated £15. You're worth a good night. thank you very, very much. Fruitcake Enema is now following. Well, thanks for that.
That's probably the most disturbing thing I've heard today.
Probably. Yeah, definitely. And El Spectra is now following as well. So, what a fantastic night. What a fantastic night. We've had some great Supreme Commander, had some great shows of support, and we got a £15 donation. How fantastic is that?
Speaking of support, you remember I mentioned that anti-air on the frigates earlier?
Oh, what a transition.
That was a solid air win for Radio Face because he engaged enemy air over top of six frigates providing air support. So we've got pretty much solid air control in the hands of Radio Face. And I think things are about to start going south for Phelom because those frigates are about to start killing off his build power.
Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt. He's got a few more naval factories planned. However, I don't think that they are ever going to get built. Well, actually, it depends on what Radio Face wants to do with these frigates. If he just wants to push out, then that's going to give time for the subs to catch up to these frigates and kill them. I mean, that's just a completely new wave of frigates.
Yeah, finally getting some frigates out.
Yeah.
If he can get those subs over on top of the enemy frigates before they can do too much damage, he should be able to mop up that force. And if he goes completely for frigate production now, he can still be in a really good position. Cool thing about UEF frigates, you see all the extra dots floating around. They actually have radar jammer. Which means they generate extra radar blips, which may not sound like anything good just right offhand, but you have to remember when subs are coming into range, they'll actually waste shots on the false blips. They'll fire torpedoes at something that isn't there.
Well, look at how many dots that looks like. I mean, Phelom will know that that's not how many there is,
but you don't know how many there are for sure.
That's intimidating. I mean, it's only five in total, but it looks like what, 20 or something? That's insane. That's very, very crazy.
You can see how the blips disappear as soon as visual contact is made.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. No. And it looks like these attack subs will manage to chase away the enemy frigates. Hopefully. Copman 021. Thanks for following. Appreciate it. Appreciate it a lot. All right. So, lots of frigates. Lots of warfare. Attack submarines, was that the right thing for Radio Face to do? Transition into attack submarines. You're not a huge fan.
I'm not a huge fan, but my prediction was wrong. Radio Face is actually not doing what I thought he was. He has built a destroyer, which has basically no anti-torpedo capabilities. So those subs are... they're still going to be a huge danger. Let me untangle my tongue here for a second.
please do.
But anyway, that's the problem with T2 UEF Navy is all of the jobs of the Navy are separated out. So your frigates are where your HP is at, your Coopers have torpedoes, your destroyers have surface damage, your shields have HP, and it's all, you have to perfectly mix all of your units together, whereas Cybern, you can pretty much just spam one unit and you're good.
Yeah. Yeah, so, that's fair enough. And these attack submarines really need to be trying to target down this destroyer. And perhaps the attack submarines first, and then definitely the destroyer.
Yes.
But for sure, the Phelom should totally take advantage of this situation that Radio Face has got himself into.
Yeah, he needs to have all his Navy together. You've got strings of frigates out both sides that could have been a pretty sizable Navy win there. And then the cool thing about Navy wins, there's a lot of mass tied up in Navy. So if you can drop engineers on the remains of a naval battle, there is a ton of reclaim to be had. So you don't want to miss up on that kind of opportunity.
Although these frigates have managed to inflict a fair amount of damage. You know, they've taken out a couple of mass extractors. They've taken out a couple of units, a couple of engineers.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unimpressive. Not unimpressive, but I still feel that it would probably be a little bit more effective if they were grouped together.
Yeah.
I think that's probably a fair assessment. So I honestly think that that Radio Face... Oh.
Oh, did Phelom quit?
Well, let's...
He disconnected or he quit.
Well, something happened, and he's now no longer in, according to the standings, which let's head over there and see what's going on. I'm also going to read the... Radio Face is saying, think Phelom's internet may have died. Timed out for 2 minutes. He isn't even online. Something, something, something.
Internet died.
That's a real shame.
I really think that isn't going to change the outcome of that match because Phelom had dug himself into a pretty deep hole on that one.
Yeah, without a doubt.
That T1 sub spam was wrong. The UEF beat him to T2 Navy. He was slipping a little bit on control. Unless something drastically changed in like the next 2 minutes, he was. Although that's a nice little group of gunships up there in the corner.
I honestly don't think that that match would have changed in direction. I think it was very, very clear that that Radio Face was heading for a win. Perhaps not a massive win or an easy win, but a win nonetheless, I think.
Yeah, for sure. So that last semifinal down there, is that one started yet? Radio Face versus Sescu.
Radio Face versus Sescu. I can certainly investigate for you. it looks like it has.
It could potentially be playing already.
Potentially be playing. It's on Loki version 3. I'm going to jump in. I'm going to see if it is playing. I'm very, very doubtful if it actually is. I don't think
wonderful black screen.
A wonderful black screen, indeed. It's a very, very lovely black screen. And
looks like everybody's going to have to live with us rambling for another 3 or 4 minutes.
Well, that's a real shame. Also, I want to just thank everybody who's who's saying, oh yeah, let's get me to 100 viewers. That's awesome.
Holy crap, 95.
Yeah, man.
It's almost there.
Oh, this is so good. This is absolutely fantastic.
98? No. Two more.
This can't be the only topic of conversation. We can't just like sit here and just be like, 98?
I'm legitimately impressed. 99? It kept ticking up. I thought maybe that it was going to tip over if I gave a little gap there, a little pause, but apparently not.
Oh my goodness. It's crazy. Oh man. I'm like, this stream is like the main topic of conversation in the main FAF chat, which I find is absolutely crazy.
We have a sixth of all FAF users in this Twitch stream.
why stop at 100, guys? Why not go for 200? Why not go for 200? I mean, why stop at 100? Let's just keep on going. The more people we have, the more fun it is, and the less I can actually read of chat.
So Sescu versus Radio. Who do we think is going to win this one?
I do not know. I mean, the last game didn't really give us a very good feel on what Radio Face was capable of. You know, he did well, but I feel we didn't really get to see anything of what his potential was, you know? I just don't think so.
Yeah. Well, they both lost. Looks like actually they both lost their first matches. But they've won every match since then, so.
Their first matches, well, yes, well, yeah, they won, well, Sescu won the second match that he was playing in.
Yes, he did.
And you, Radio Face, you lost your second match as well, okay. So both of these guys lost their second match. Okay, that's an interesting sort of, an interesting point of fact, I suppose, isn't it?
Running about neck and neck, just statistically speaking.
Yeah, exactly. It's pretty interesting. It's pretty interesting, and obviously the winner of this match will be going up against Coding Squirrel, and I don't know. Who do you think is going to be the winner of this match? I mean, you've asked me. I'm going to ask you.
I'm probably going to have to go with Radio Face.
Yep.
Just because of a couple of things that I have seen with how he was using his units in the last couple of games. But what I really want to see is Coding Squirrel versus Usling, because that match was hysterical.
Yeah.
I want to see that one happen again.
It was absolutely phenomenal.
An exercise in how many ways can we not kill an ACU?
It was great. It was really good.
Makes for right on the edge of your seat viewing.
Oh, totally, totally, totally. All right. But yeah, I really hope that Coding Squirrel goes through to be against Usling again. I think that would be something special to remember, without a doubt. Oh man,
think that match is launched yet? Or
I will go and check right now. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to follow, then that's cool. If you want to donate, then you're awesome. And if you want to subscribe to us on YouTube, then you're pretty epic too. So go and do that. And yeah, I guess not much more to say, really, is there?
Not too much, other than please let this game start. Oh, ah!
Beautiful. Beautiful.
We're here.
Beautiful. Oh, okay. All right. I'm excited for this game as well, actually. Even though it's oh, nice map. Interesting. So, what immediately strikes you about this map, specifically?
This map has one of the most unique unit flows out of any of them in the 1v1 map pool.
Okay.
Because you have puddles of water, you have civilian blockages, you have on and off ramps for the plateaus, tons of different avenues of access that you have to keep your eye on. Plus, the map is not that small, so drops can potentially be useful and air control is a must. But it's kind of one of those maps that set up where you have channels that units come through, but nothing is narrow enough that you can turtle effectively. Like, point defense is going to be circumvented or overrun because of rough terrain. So you really have to be a master of unit mixes and unit movements to win on this map.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so Radio Face is saying, good luck, have fun, stop watching everyone else. Okay, he's on to us. He's on to us and our devious ways. Darn it. Darn it, darn it. All right.
Does that technically count as breaking the fourth wall?
I think it does, actually. Although, I suppose it's not really very arrogant to think that we would be doing this in the first place, because we've been doing it pretty much all night, or I've been doing it all night. You, of course, slacked off for like the first half. Anyway, sorry, Get Swifty, thanks for following, and John Ice 227, again, thanks for following. Okay, so what sort of advancements are we going to see? Are we going to see an early tech 2? Are we going to see a longer tech 1? What's going to happen here?
Because of the unit size, I think we're going to see a fairly quick movement to T2, but obviously, since you have to maintain a hold on such a large map, T1 is still going to be critical. If you try to rush T2 very, very, very early, you're not going to have enough units on the map to block off attacks from the other player. So I'm thinking probably 7-8 minutes, we're going to see a T2 unit somewhere around in there.
Yeah. Okay, 7-8 minutes. So interesting. Interesting. Is there a specific Tech 2 unit that would be of advantage to the UEF or to the Cybran player?
Well, there's a couple of different ways it could go. You could potentially get in the amphibious tanks of either faction.
Okay.
And you would be able to cross the water in the back of the base.
Yeah.
See, there's an extra channel back there which could potentially be un or under defended. Mm-hmm. So if you can slip some assault tanks around the back, that could be very, very useful. But I think we're probably just going to see some main tanks, possibly range bots from the Cybern side paired with stealth to kind of try to kite out and get that extra bit of damage.
Mm-hmm. Well, both of the players want to build a factory over on the plateaued section up here.
Yes.
And up here. And this seems to be the main area that they're going to try and produce units from, I suppose, if the access ramp is right there.
Yes, it has a good access to both sides of the map. And also there's 3 mass extractors up there that you want to protect. Mm-hmm. You can also reclaim those civilian trucks and buildings up there on the plateau. So
yeah.
It makes for a good base of operations.
So how much mass are all of these labs? Because I have no idea. I'm holding down
not
control
much.
Shift.
Okay. It's like 100 or less, I think. Which, yeah. I mean, okay. You still want to reclaim because every bit of mass is useful, but it's not like you're going to strike a gold mine by getting out there. And yes, someone commenting in there, Brink's lack of knowledge on this map is epic. I will take that one. I have what I think are educated guesses, but I haven't played this map as much as I have some other ones, so we'll just see how it plays out.
Well, in all honesty, whatever Brink's lack of knowledge is, it's still fantastically more than mine. So that's just it, I suppose.
People are going to correct us in the chat anyway. I'm already getting things on the 100 or less comment. Apparently, those buildings are worth more than that.
Oh, shame on you.
Shame on me.
Shame on you. Shame on you. Oh, my goodness, dude. Oh, man. It's crazy, though. It's crazy. It's a really, really interesting map, and I don't imagine that this would be one of the most played. I don't think so, anyway. I imagine that this is probably one of the least played maps, you know, in this tournament so far. I think it's one of the most original and unique ones that we've seen so far.
Mm-hmm. Although, I like this one, and I like Rieger Highlands. They both kind of tend to bring out really weird sides of play. Mm-hmm. Just mm-hmm. things out of the ordinary.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Oh, look. We've got a bomber here. That is definitely going to take out that engineer. And I think it already got a kill, did it? I think it got a kill. I think it took out a bomber already.
BC Blackheart is in here. Blackheart, how much reclaim is in the civilian buildings? Because if anyone knows, you know.
Oh my goodness. We've got 90 people in the chat right now. How crazy is that? That is freaking awesome. Two kills on this attack bomber. I presume that those two kills are engineers. I don't think that's being presumptuous in the
More
slightest.
Than likely. So, it's circling over the hydro, so yeah.
Exactly. And yeah, the hydro had already been started construction, so I'm going to say that that's a fairly educated guess. So, you know, the bomber has made its mass back. You know, that's what I've heard anyway. Just a rumor. But you need to kill two engineers.
Still got to get in that one plug per game.
Oh, dude, totally. I mean, if you're going to be splitting this up on your YouTube channel, then I need to make sure that I tease you about it in every single game so that the viewers can get the maximum effect, without a doubt.
For the record, I was right. Blackheart commenting, the ones in the corners are 30 mass or something small like that. So they are 100 or less.
Okay, that's fair enough. So it's not as much as a totem or a rock or anything like that. It's
but still just not something you want to die over.
No, exactly. See, that seems a little bit daft, right? Because these seem like pretty chunky structures, don't they?
They do.
Why are they not more mass? I mean, I suppose that would change the whole dynamic of the map if they were worth a lot of mass, because you just see, like, engineers and units rushing forward to this central area.
It would be like some kind of Japanese horror movie, because you would have giant robot commanders descending on a small city and then destroying all of the buildings systematically and sucking them up to build war machines.
Oh,
I mean,
man.
If that's not the very definition of an 80s horror movie type deal,
totally.
I don't know what is.
It's freaking Godzilla remastered 2015 edition. Yeah, totally.
I love that little bomber down in the bottom left. He finally died. There were three interceptors that got on his tail, but he had a bunch of kills. He was still circling around.
Oh, man. This is really turning out to be a little bit slower than I expected, to be honest. We haven't seen any major engagements between either player. There's not been anything massive. There's no full assault of the enemy base. There's no all in. There's no nothing. There's just a good solid amount of expansion and a tiny little bit of harassment that will probably yield nothing.
Well, it's kind of all part of feeling out your opponent. You don't want to overcommit because you don't want to take a big loss this early in the game. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you've got to spread out and get everything, which is actually kind of surprising to me, because on the right side of the map, you got two unclaimed mass extractors for radio phase. Not sure why those are just sitting there out in the open, but he needs to get an engineer back to the back of his base.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Wait, where the hell are we talking about right now? Two
on the right side, here. Next to that hydro.
Yep. Right here. Okay, I'm with you there. There was actually a bomber that took out the engineers that were heading down towards that, but I don't think he's even...
No new ones dispatched, though. It's been sitting empty for a while now.
That's a real shame. That's a real shame, because I think some engineers would seriously enjoy exploiting this lovely patch of land. I mean, this is a safe area, so I don't understand why you wouldn't take it up. Although, I suppose, if you want to be, you know, technical about it, if you don't have any more engineers to dedicate to building mass extractors, it's probably better to go and get the exposed ones and then come back to the safe ones and build them up at a later date. Maybe. I don't know.
Maybe, but I can't find a whole lot of sense in that one.
I know even less than I know even less about what I'm talking about in comparison to Mr. Insanity over there. It is shameful how little I know about this game. Absolutely shameful.
Zlow is commenting in the chat that apparently those civilian walls are indestructible, which I did not know.
Okay.
I don't know if that's correct or not.
They look pretty indestructible.
7,000 health. Oh, no. 1 out of 1.
1 out of 1. That sounds pretty indestructible. I don't really know. I honestly don't know. Okay, we're seeing a slight engagement here. Okay. Some medium tanks against some assault bots. Okay, I dig it. I think this could do some damage. Especially to some potential build power, to some mass extractors, and most importantly to the engineers, I feel.
There's also a drop coming in on the top end, but it looks like those interceptors are going to snipe it off.
Well, they're
not running to intercept, so we're actually going to see it touch down. There's two more interceptors and an anti-air turret in the back. Health's going to drop real fast on that.
Oh, no. So close.
This is so when you close. Need paratrooper engineers.
Very, very much so, because that was a lot of wasted lives, unfortunately, or a lot of wasted.
It looks like we have a T2
robots.
Factory, though.
A Tier 2 factory? By who?
Is it, or am I seeing things? By right there on the plateau. Yes, it is.
Indeed. That's a risky choice for a Tech 2. Wow, that's quite an aggressive play. Rather than going for a safe Tech 2 factory back at base, you decide to go for fairly advanced Tech 2 factory. Okay, so that could be a sign.
The advantage of that is going
to
be when that unit rolls off the line, it's going to be at the front line quicker.
Exactly, so. And that's what I mean. It's going to be a fairly aggressive play to go for the Tech 2 land factory up there. Has Mr. Radioface done the same, and is he thinking about it? I'm not entirely sure.
I don't see one yet.
I don't see one either. I mean, nothing here of interest, perhaps back at base. No tier 2 investment as of yet. Potentially in the future, though. Well, almost definitely in the future.
Interesting point of fact. Sescu has actually gone T2 engineer first.
Okay.
Which is still parked there by the land factory. I was kind of curious as to what he plans with that. If he's going for like an early T2 power generator to get some T2 air online, or what he's doing. It looks like he's building a flat cannon.
Yep.
For defense.
Yeah, it looks like it. It's kind of crazy.
Not necessarily a bad idea. It's kind of armoring up that position. He's got a point defense plan too.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure he definitely wants to protect this Tech 2 land factory. I mean, that must be top on the list of priorities for him to do. But also, I did notice a sneaky unit that I've never seen before. This is a mobile stealth field system?
Yes.
Oh, I had seen it. I have seen it before. I saw it in another game.
It's the specialty unit for Cybern. Instead of mobile shielding, they have mobile stealth.
Wow. Okay, so this is effectively going to hide half of his forces, is it?
Yeah, if you go to his name and then click on the unit, there's a little brown circle around it that shows the stealth radius.
Okay.
Which is not huge, but it's fairly significant.
That is significant, actually.
Yeah, if you clump up your units around that nicely or spread 3 or 4 stealth units through your force, you can effectively conceal, 30 units and force them to one side of the map before the other player can respond.
That's fairly good. I mean, he's doing a fairly good job of clumping his units up around this stealthy unit, wherever the heck it's gone. There it is.
And this is actually going to be a nice little push here. Going to get right up in the build power. And if those tanks don't pull back very quickly, he could potentially lose a factory or two. Oh, there's a point defense in the back, though.
Nicely positioned point defense here. Engineers, kill the engineers. Kill the engineers, kill the factories. I think that's probably the best thing to do in this case, because that point defense is going to be fairly hard to kill, I would imagine.
And it's behind the protection of those walls, so only a couple of Mantis are going to be able to actually put bullets in it, and it's just going to demolish everything.
Yeah.
What is the kill count on that, actually?
It's doing a lot of damage. I would love to know. Let's go and find out, see what it is. 13, 14 kills and counting. 15.
That's going to pull up on 3 veterancy.
Oh my goodness.
3 veterancy.
18 kills. 18 kills.
That definitely paid for itself.
That it totally paid for itself. Holy cow, that's amazing. A very, very significant investment by the Cybran player, and not one that I'm entirely sure paid off.
I don't think it did. He left a nice little mass present there.
Oh.
Blue.
It's GG. Apparently, it doesn't even matter. It's GG.
Scroll back. Let's see the map control.
How the hell do I scroll back?
He overpowered... just zoom out.
Okay.
He overpowered the top side as well. So he had narrowed down the map control to that tiny little segment. He had T2 land rolling, support factories in his spawn, and it looks like Radio Face just conceded. It's not worth it.
Really, really isn't. Really, really isn't. And especially, you know, down here as well. And up here, there was just too much.
There was very, very effective map control from Sescu.
Very, very much so. I mean, we've talked about this previously, but the Cybran, you know, is one of the factions that prides itself in its ability to control the map in the early stages of the game. And I think that a textbook example has just been displayed today. So, absolutely fantastic. Fantastic game.
Exactly.
GG to both players. That was a good one. Let's go and have a look at the standings. Let's see what the heck is going on. I will exit out of Forged Alliance. All right. Fantastic. Nothing has been updated as of yet.
So it's going to be Coding Squirrel versus Sescu, and then the winner of that is going to go versus Usling.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. What is going on in the chat? All right. There's going to be a best of 3, apparently. Okay. Sescu 1. Let me just switch over and see the... Yeah, you guys can see what the hell is going on right now. All right. 30 minutes. 30 minutes.
Williamson's Bridge. This is going to be funny.
Williamson's Bridge. I would suspect that this is a fairly small map.
Tiny.
Dude,
very tiny.
We have 100 viewers. 100 viewers.
Nice.
Oh my goodness.
I need a New Year's whistle or something to blow.
102 viewers. Oh my goodness. This is crazy. This is like a factor of 10 larger than what I normally get at a stream. Oh my goodness. How crazy. How flipping crazy.
Well, I think this time around, you guys have only got to deal with us for about 4 minutes because Sescu and Coding have already launched.
Oh, my. Look at this, right? Look at what Zoc is saying in the chat. He's bad-mouthing the fantastic commentary team in the chat. Look, Radio Face is saying, holy shit, Zoc, I'm not ready for fame. And Zoc says, too late. They don't really talk about the game, though. What the hell? What the hell, dude? What the heck? What the heck? That's a shame. That's a real shame. Well, I'm gonna try opening up the game, but I'm fairly sure that we're not gonna have access to it quite yet. We're gonna have to wait for the.
No, it's probably gonna be another 3 minutes or so.
Yeah. That's no problem. That's okay. Okay. Everybody, if you're interested in subscribing, following, please do. It would be fairly awesome. If you want to donate, that would also be pretty awesome, because money is pretty sweet, actually. Sweet, sweet cash. If you're interested in making these more of a regular basis, which I think is something that both me and Brink are interested in doing. Is that fair to say?
Fair to say.
Oh, man. How long have we been going now? Well, I've been going for 5 hours straight.
I'm on 2.5 at the moment, so...
Ugh. Oh,
taking up from here.
Oh, back in my day. It's ACOG is a noob. I don't know who ACOG is, but I feel sorry for him. Oh man. All right. Oh, I'm loving SUPCOM. I'm loving SUPCOM. It's just fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
Radio Face, did you see my cheese on Rigor? Is that the Trying to remember if that's the one that we watched. I'm now interested, because anytime anyone talks about cheesing up a tournament, usually hilarity ensued.
Oh, in fact, we've got Sarah 2. ACOG is a noob. That is, in fact, Sarah 2 from earlier. Capsless.
Nice.
Capsless is now following. I don't really know who Capsless is. I think he was in this tournament. I'm fairly sure he was, but I know he's friends with Ratzoop. I know that. And I'm not entirely sure if Capsless was in the tournament, but hey-ho. It's all a bit of banter, really, isn't it? It's all a bit of banter.
Calmly remarking in Aeolus, tagged me in it, saying, Loki is the land of T3 Rush, which I can actually see, because there's enough distance between the bases and enough of a convoluted path back and forth that you could get to T3 pretty quickly. So I can see that one.
Mm-hmm. Hunky Gladiator is now following. Thank you very, very much. I appreciate it greatly. Very, very kind of everybody to follow. I don't know how many people have followed tonight, but it's been kind of crazy. IC3NI, thanks very much for following. Very, very nice of you. Okay. No, I don't think we saw. I don't think that we saw that cheesy game. Mad for Muse. Awesome. Thank you very much for following. I appreciate it. It's very nice of you. No, we should totally check out that cheesy game. Cheesy games are good. I like cheesy games.
All right, are we gonna launch this time?
I'm giving it a shot. I'm not entirely hopeful, but I'm hopeful, nonetheless.
Looks like we got one more minute.
Oh, that's not a problem. You know what? Patience is a virtue, and I am quite happy waiting for something if it's gonna be freaking awesome, which I know it will be. Because Coding Squirrel, I think he's my favorite to win. I think he's a fan favorite as well. I'll be honest. I think he is a fan favorite. I think people will be cheering for him. I'm not entirely sure that people like the whole Usling play, bringing it over 45 minutes, that whole round of rock and whatnot. But
yeah,
I don't know.
I think if we had a highlights reel, the ring around the Rosie with the Percival would definitely be on it.
That was good. That was probably a fairly dishonorable play, but it worked. You gotta give him credit for that.
Well, I don't know that there's any dishonor in trying not to die.
that is a fair point. That is a fair point. Oh man. Oh my goodness. Okay, I'm going to try once again to boot up into the game. Fingers crossed it works. I'm somewhat hopeful this time. Indeed it does. Fantastic.
Back in once again. I can tell from the UEF loading screen that you play UEF.
Do I? Apparently I do.
Apparently. The last game that you launched into, you were UEF.
Oh my goodness. All right, that's great. Okay, so very, very small map here. And an interesting sort of setup. How is it going to go? How is the game going to progress? Are we going to see a massive early game rush? Are we going to see sort of a turtly build? Is either one possible? I'm not really sure.
Usually you see a lot of T1 on this map. A lot of T1 units. Obviously, there are three lanes. There's a center lane, and then you got right and left. And the cool thing about this map is that base swaps are kind of a regular thing. I think I've seen more base swaps on Williamson's Bridge than any other map. And I hope that we get one here, because it's freaking hysterical when it happens. But there was a legendary game many, many moons ago where there was like three base swaps in the same game where the guys were basically circling each other around the map, and neither one of them could get an established base. And it was just hysterical to watch. But I doubt we'll see something like that, but I would love to see a base swap.
Oh, man. I think a base swap would be pretty freaking sweet, if I do say so myself. Oh, man. I think this is crazy. One Battlefront 1 is now following. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. I appreciate it a lot. All right, so air, is that going to be an option for players, or is air going to be one of those things that is just sort of left to the side and not really dealt with?
It really depends. One of the problems with Williamson's Bridge is that the mass is kind of restricted. There's not a whole lot of mass extractor points. So you've got to use your resources wisely.
Uh-huh.
And I have seen quite a few games played entirely on land with air never making an appearance. But I wouldn't rule it out because air can be incredibly useful in any game.
Yeah. Yeah, without a doubt. Without a doubt. We don't see anybody building an air factory as of yet, do we?
I mean, not yet. Couple of land factories going down.
Yeah. Okay.
Pretty typical.
Okay. We are seeing Coding's ACU do a little bit more of an adventurous sort of play style than Sesko's. That's not really going anywhere. It's not really going anywhere yet. That looks like it's going to be constructing the... Indeed it is. The land factory. Okay. I can dig that, and it looks like he's setting up for yet another factory up in the top left.
Yep, and you can see he's already got manual reclaim orders scattered around with his engineers trying to pick up those rocks that are on the edges of the cliffs there. So that's going to help push him up. He's already planning his second land factory, so he's going to try to get more land units online as quickly as he possibly can, which is usually a pretty solid plan as long as you got the mass to back it up. So just have to see if he can get enough on board to pull it off.
I think that you know, three land factories with not very many mass extractors in this early stage of the game is going to be fairly difficult to maintain, to be honest. I think,
yeah,
you know, let's be
he's
frank
got
about
the
it.
Two down. He I has think that one, power generator two. Configuration in the back is for a future air factory.
An air factory.
That template, yeah, that template is typically where you set an air factory inside of, but yeah. It could just be his power grid. You never know.
Yeah, I think an air factory would go fairly perfectly in there. I mean, theoretically, if you were wanting to build a land factory, you would probably build it near the front of combat so you could...
Yeah, and it'd be better to put it adjacent to a mechs rather than a power generator because you're not going to save much power on a land unit.
Exactly. So I think that it's entirely possible that we see that an air factory.
There's the third.
Another land factory going down. So yes, it does indeed look like this is a setup for an air factory. Pretty sweet. Pretty freaking sweet. Let's take a look and see what Squirrel is doing. Wow, he's got big plans for his land expansion as well.
Five,
and still no sign of air.
We can pretty much safely say that he's not planning on air because five land factories on this amount of mass extractors is going to wrap him.
Yeah.
But he is doing a lot better on his expansion. He is 4 ticks ahead on mass per second, and he is doing very well on his expansion. So he may actually have the income to back it up. Looking very well balanced right now.
Very much so. Very, very much so, actually.
It's kind of interesting. You can kill yourself building power. I know that power stalling is horrendous, and I will stand by that comment. But if you build too many power generators... That means that you've wasted mass on power that you're now overflowing.
Mm-hmm.
So one thing that I did notice is that Sesku seemed like he was overbuilding a little bit in the early part of the game. He has lower mass income and he has the same power income. But since he is throwing down an air factory, he can probably justify that. Whereas Coding Squirrel is pretty much balanced on 0 and plus 30, which is the sweet spot. I mean, that's exactly where you want to be.
That's awesome. That's really, really cool. Oh, sweet.
A little bit of a raid there on the right. I can see that mech's dying. It means there's a tank up over there.
Something is definitely going on over there. Oh, it's not a tank.
That is the ASU. Super aggressive.
Very, very aggressive.
I don't think he's in any real danger, though, because there's not enough tanks on the field to actually damage him enough to where it wouldn't be a mutual KO. If one of them killed the other, because obviously, if you're not above 2,500 HP when you kill the other guy, the death nuke is going to kill your ACU as well. So it's really not worth it unless you're like, oh, I'm already losing this. I'm gonna force a draw.
Yeah. I can understand that. Oh man, what an interesting little map with with crazy little stuff. It seems that Coding has been investing more heavily into his factories than our friend up in the north. Air, still nothing to show for this this air factory. Nothing yet at all.
I'm hoping that we'll see a Jester. Jesters would be fun.
Jesters being the...
T1 gunships.
T1 gunships.
Yes, another unique unit for the Cyberns.
Wow.
It's looks like basically it's a T2 unit available at T1. I mean, it's got a ludicrous amount of health. It gets around the map pretty quickly. It does a really good amount of damage. The T2 gunship is better, but you don't have to pay for the T2 upgrade to get a couple of Jesters out. Mm-hmm. And Jesters is a raiding unit or are horrendously difficult to get rid of.
Okay. That's pretty cool. I think Jesters will be fairly interesting. However, looks like Coding managed to slip a few units behind enemy lines.
Not really to any benefit, though. They not all got wiped out, didn't even drop a mechs.
That was... They probably should have targeted down that mechs if they were going to do anything, because if they were just going to die, you know, so... Hey-ho, the commander is still in a fairly advanced position. Both of them are, actually. They're both almost toe-to-toe.
Pretty much. The map control is a little bit better for the South player. Mm-hmm. Coding Squirrel is spreading out better, and he's capturing more mass extractors, which is showing in his eco. I think unless Sesku does something creative, he is eventually going to get overpowered, but it's a little too early to call that. At this point, I would be trying for a gun upgrade, but I don't know what route he is going to take on that one.
Sweet. Okay, so apparently, yes, indeed, there is an air factory planned for Squirrel, according to Zocky Zoc.
Yes.
Sweet. I can dig an air factory. I mean, if your opponent's putting up an air factory, then that seems like a fairly legitimate reason. That's a Jester right there.
We got to see it.
It's a thing. It's
ACU totally is running. One side of that T1 gunship, and he's like, "Help! Help! Get me back to the base!"
Yeah, Zocky Zoc is saying Sesko missed his opportunity to use that advantage on air. Indeed, it looks like that is the case. I mean, as soon as this air factory is up, I would imagine some interceptors will be in position to shoot down this gunship in short order.
Looks like it is going to make good work, though. Till it does go down, he's cleaning up those little tanks nicely, mm-hmm. Moving around the outside edges. So I don't really have any complaints on the use of it.
No, of course
yeah,
not.
He did take a little while to get that unit out of the factory.
Yeah. It just seemed like it wasn't really a priority to him for some reason.
Yeah.
He didn't really try to grab that early advantage with both hands. He doesn't actually have an anti-air turret up here, so... You know, if the Jester decides to make its way uptown, then that could still be an issue for this area over here, and specifically this point defense, which has already been invested in. So, you never know what happens. You never know.
It is headed south.
It's headed south to the land of no anti-air, apart from the mobile.
Mobile on the way, though.
Yeah, okay. That's not too shabby. It's better than nothing.
The more I'm looking at this, the more that I think Sesku is doomed.
Really?
Doomed. Yeah, if you look at the map control, I mean,
yeah,
Coding Squirrel is literally double his eco.
I think that's correct.
Holds a lot of the map. Granted, the push on the left is going to get pretty dang far, but I think he can stop it, and he's already got so much rolling that I don't think Sesko is going to be able to recover.
Yeah.
You never know, though. Games always change in SubCom.
Exactly.
Could be wrong.
Exactly. Although, you know, all this time, while Coding has the advantage of mass extractors, he's just pumping out units, you know? He's just building stuff. He's building as much as he can. And at long last, we're going to see the Jester engaged. Doesn't look like the interceptor is going to be enough to finish it off. Looks like three supporting interceptors are going to stop the Jester from getting taken out. Certainly looks that way.
That's such a huge amount of health on that unit.
Yeah.
I mean, the 500 plus on a T1 unit is pretty dang ridiculous.
Yeah, indeed it is. We've got quite a lot of potential reclaim on the battlefield that is ready to be gobbled up at a moment's notice.
Yeah, and when, you know, you have few mass extractors like this, that is where you have to excel.
Yeah.
You got to wring every bit of mass that you possibly can out of the map. And I don't see any engineers heading over that way from the left. which is not good because if the unit count goes up for Coding Swirl again and he's able to reclaim that territory, then that's going to push him even farther ahead. He's down a couple of mass ticks. He's down to 21 versus 13 once this mass extractor dies. But it's still mass advantage to Coding Squirrel in a big, big way.
I feel that this entire offensive by Sesko has done pretty much nothing. I mean, what, he got a mass extractor?
Three mass extractors.
Three mass extractors. Cleared
out the left side as well. Those units are obviously going to die, but he has enough up there to replace them. So that side is secure.
I feel it's questionable, that offensive, and whether it was worth it. I suppose it does deny the mass, but... Hey ho, we're gonna see some commander sparring up here.
I like that little radar up on the cliff.
That's a very sneaky radar, indeed it is. You know, this is a prime opportunity for Coding just to splurge into this area and just, you know, take out whatever the hell is up here. You know, an engineer, a mass extractor, and a radar. You know, that would be very, very easy to do. There's not much intelligence on this area, I feel.
Maybe he'll push. It looks like he is. He is going up in that direction. And I do see Sesko did get an engineer out. So he is reclaiming on the left side. So hopefully he will be able to get some of that mass and make good use of it.
Good on him. Good on him. That is absolutely what is the best idea.
I can't help but feel like there's a lot of misused mass on this map, though, because there's point defense all over the place.
Yeah.
And you need the mobility. I don't really think that those point defense are doing him any good at all. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a weird choice to build them at all, and especially to build them where he did.
Yeah. I can sort of understand that, although I suppose he doesn't... He never really had the early intelligence to say... You know, this is what my opponent's going to be doing. He just had to play it safe, I guess. And by playing it safe, you know, he sort of goes for point defense. I can understand that, but I think that's...
This could be bad.
Bad for
who? He's got 15 tanks coming down on him and that ACU firing as well.
And there is no overcharge facility available. This
but
is
he does have
mistake.
Tanks coming up from the back, and red split off to get those units that were heading into the back. So, Harry, situation averted. I think we're fine.
There
on that
is
one.
Is really I really think there's no excuse to not have energy storage up by this point in the game. I mean, especially if you're engaging in commander combat, so to speak. I just don't understand why you wouldn't have one single energy storage built. That just seems daft.
Yeah, I mean, well, if you're using all your mass, like Sesko is, then I can kind of see it, sort of, but when you're literally sitting there with mass in storage, like Coding Squirrel is, then, yeah, there's no excuse. That is a gun upgrade. Sesko's in the chat there, upgrading gun, speed, range. So that is going to be a tremendously helpful tool for him. That's going to let him just waste that group of T1 units and then double his DPS versus the commander. So that may give him the upper hand that he needs. And the eco is actually drawing even as well. It's, that may have been reclaim. Strike that from the record.
Okay.
Reclaim screwing up the numbers again.
Reclaim always screwing up the numbers. Understandable. However, the commander is slightly out of... Well, I suppose he's not really out of place over here, but he's... Unless he wants to cancel this this upgrade, he's not going to want to move his commander.
He's also mass stalled. He's minus 19, which means that upgrade is going to take forever to finish. He actually needs to pause some of his factories if he wants that upgrade. Get the upgrade, then start the factories later. Mm-hmm. Because the longer he sits there, the more likely it is that either he's going to get artillery creeped... Or he's crippling his unit production or whatever. Okay, what's happening is there's too many things going on at one time. He's also got a T2 HQ. He's trying to upgrade everything at the same time, and he simply does not have the mass. So it's just crippling him.
I couldn't really agree more, to be honest. He's really committing a lot to this gun upgrade, but I don't really know if it's going to be worth it. I mean... Questionable to say the least. Apparently, somebody has not reclaimed the big rocks. That's what I'm hearing from chat. Look, there's a whole patch of rocks up here that just haven't been claimed. Not to mention the husks of all of the dead allies around him. What a shame.
Well, I don't think he had a chance to reclaim that group quite yet. But no. Yeah, the rocks in the back definitely should have been picked up earlier.
Yep, without a doubt. How is the commander doing? He looks like he's round about 2/5 to 1/2. Completed on his gun upgrade.
But now he's 30 mass stalled. He's even more mass stalled than he was before.
It looks like he's restarted production of engineers in the land factory. And, oh, Squirrel decides that it's an appropriate time to upgrade his gun. I don't really think he needs to, I'll be honest with you. I don't think that that's entirely necessary. But, hey-ho.
I think he could just walk in and win it.
I think he probably could. I mean,
Sesku is like, oh, I need this to finish faster, so I should mass stall harder.
that's. I think that there's actually a high probability that Squirrel finishes his gun upgrade before Sesku does, and if not before, then at a very, very similar time. So, I don't know. I still don't think Coding Squirrel necessarily needs the gun upgrade to win. But
no, especially if the arty fire keeps raining down on that commander, he's probably just going to win right there.
Yeah, without a
There's
doubt.
No point in abandoning the upgrade at this point, and he's just going to sit there and soak fire. So, that's it. I failed so hard. I really hate to agree.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Oh, man. That's so good. I love it. That's fantastic.
Let's just be glad I'm not the one playing, because let's face it, I'm not a 1v1 player, as I have made readily apparent on multiple occasions, and I would probably faceplant so hard in even this tournament. I mean, it would... Yeah, I'd definitely not be the winner.
that was actually an interesting game. A really, really good one. A really, really good one. A good game. Okay.
So that puts us down to the final? Yes?
Yes, I think so. Oozling versus Coding Squirrel. How crazy is that? How freaking crazy is that? This is it.
This is the rematch that we were asking for. What's the map on this one?
The map on this one. Let's have a look at the chat to see what the hell is going on. 45 minutes to 9. Do we have? So best of 1, you have to win 2. Are you okay with Wait, what? There's going to be... The rules say best of 1. I'd like to do best of 3. I didn't think about it before. Only if both of you two are okay with it. Okay, so it's going to be a best of 3. Okay.
Looks like we still got a couple of games in here.
I think so. Oh, God. This is bloody marathon. Absolute marathon. Twin Rivers first. 45 minutes from now. Wow. Okay. Let's settle in for the long haul, guys. Settle in for the long haul.
Oh, man. That's a bit long to wait, isn't it?
It's a long time. I don't know how large these maps are going to be as well. Like, I really have no idea. Potentially 2 best of 3s. Well, yeah, that's assuming that you know, the wins are consecutive. However, if it's 1 to Oozling, 1 to Coding Squirrel, then you know, that's going to be 3 games. That's a long time. That's a long, long time. That could potentially be another 3 hours.
Nah, let's hope not.
2.5 hours potentially. Oh. I'm not entirely convinced this whole double elimination thing. I think that confuses things, to be honest. I like it.
A little bit. I've always been a fan of single elimination, but at the same time, I can see how that would make it where one single stupid game or one disconnect doesn't completely eliminate a player.
Exactly. That's my issue with it.
Yeah, it's tough to call. I mean, you could do the thing where disconnect results in a rematch, but then you can get into some real gray areas because people might purposely disconnect to try to get the rematch, that kind of thing. But yeah, it does make for a little bit of a longer tournament, especially for only having, what, we didn't even have 30 people in this one, did we? I don't think
there
so.
was 27, I think. Well, it was about 30 people, but not everybody turned up, so yeah. Oh, man. Man, oh, man, oh, man. Man, oh, man, oh, man. This is great. It's great. It is nice that you get a second chance. That's obviously the best thing about this setup, which is pretty freaking sweet. Anybody else want to follow, make a donation? Because you totally could if you wanted to. Subscribe on YouTube if that's something you're interested in.
I was just looking over in the chat. Speed 2, maybe single elimination where every round is best out of 3. That's not helping! Single elimination, but you have to play a minimum of 2 games for every stage.
That's intense.
That is an intense tournament and even longer.
Yeah. That's crazy.
Jonas, question, how do you get the builds, upgrades, etc. mapped to the keyboard buttons? Press F1 in the game. Well, yep, somebody already hit it in the chat. So anyway, press F1 while you're playing in the game. There's a complete hotkey list for a stupid amount of options, even down to show network stats and some of the console commands that you can map to hotkeys. So it should be everything you could ever hope and dream for in there.
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's fantastic. Holy cow, it is fantastic. It's great. It's been a fantastic night of Supreme Commander plays, in all honesty. It's been good. It has been good.
Absolutely. What are we now? Fifth hour? Five and a half?
5.5 hours that I have been going literally all the time. Not even a drink of water. Not
Dang.
Even a flipping drink of water. Dedication. Am I right?
Yeah, that's right. I have to admit, that's why I took that 45-second break earlier.
Really? Oh, man.
I ran and grabbed something to drink real quick and made it back.
Oh, I think, you know what? I think I might get a drink of water.
Have at it, man.
You know what? I'm going to totally do that. All right. You entertain the crowds for 45 seconds or whatever, and I will go and get a drink of water.
45 seconds might be a challenge because I am not exactly the comedic relief half of this.
What are you saying? I'm the comedic relief? Well, I am actually the comedic relief. That was stupid. Yeah, all right. Well, do your best, man. Good luck.
Oh, man. To the people in chat commenting, yeah, that is the harsh reality of asking for key designations in chats, because inevitably there will be people who tell you that it is Control-K. And I have seen several people actually Control-K their commanders because of that comment, and it's both hilarious and sad. Thankfully, it only happens once, because then you know what is actually going on. But anywho. Patrick Pone's coming in. I can entertain the chat, but only if you put 18 plus. I have no control over that because that is not my stream. I do find it interesting that the BC clan has shown a presence, though. You're here.
I'm here.
Awesome.
What's the banter? Anything?
Nothing much.
Anything of craziness happened while I was gone? I hope not.
Not at all.
All right, good.
Managed to maintain the brink of insanity, but haven't pulled over the edge quite yet.
That is good. That is good. All right. What's happening?
Apparently, Petrick has been voted for public entertainer, and we are still waiting for a game to take place.
That is a good point. I shall check. Carbon-based says, hey, Brink, you've got Orbit of Potato playing SUPCOM. Have you played any Planetary Annihilation with him? No, you haven't played any Planetary Annihilation with me, but you have played Planetary Annihilation in the past, though, haven't you?
I have not.
Have you not? I thought you had.
No, I haven't. My view of that game is forever tainted by the developers. The whole Kickstarter finagle and all of the things that followed that, and some of the, quite frankly, stupidity of the heads of development and stuff on that, it just kind of soured that entire experience, and I haven't actually picked it up. So I should try it, especially with the Titans being out, but I just have not gotten around to it yet.
It's interesting, and I really like the art style. It's fairly nice, actually. That's my favorite part of the game, the art style. All right, this map is Twin Rivers. Is there any potential naval base integration?
Every once in a while, you might see some crazy person dip his toe into the water and spit out a cruiser or three, which can be kind of hilarious, but you have to already be ahead in the game, because if you invest that mass into Navy, you're obviously going to have fewer land units. It doesn't happen that often. Typically, this map is nothing but spam. Tons and tons of spam.
Okay, any air spam? Does air play an important role in this game?
Air always plays a part. But usually this map is decided by the initial build, because if you don't expand properly, because the map is divided into a couple of lanes, it's really hard to recover from runarounds. Mm-hmm. But it depends on the early build, and that depends on who can get enough spam out to tech up, and then where the game goes from there. Cybern, like I was saying in the other game, is obviously going to have an early game advantage here because they have faster units. So we're going to see potentially a lot of run-bys from Cybern early on. Mm-hmm. And hopefully they can do enough of that to make up the difference when UEF starts turtling up. And UEF, if they can survive that raiding stage, there's so many mass extractors on this map that once the tech starts rolling, it's going to tech up really, really quickly. So
I would say, from my limited experience, that this matchup favors the Cybern player. You know, we've seen how well Uzling was managed to manipulate, space and whatnot. And I see that there is no reason why he cannot do a similar thing again. So I would say this matchup favors Uzling. You know, there's a lot of open space, and Uzling has been good at controlling space.
If he doesn't power stall. That was the end of him that last game.
That is a good point. That is a very
Someone
very
in chat pointing out, I said, who can get more spam to get the tech up? What I meant by that is, if you don't have enough units on the map and you try to tech up too early, you will fail at map control because you don't have enough units. So you have to get early units out to cover your expansions so that you can then tech up without taking the losses. Mm-hmm. That is really convoluted. Maybe it doesn't make sense, but it kind of makes sense in my head. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know.
A little bit of a power stall going on here. Looks like Coding is endeavoring to rectify it now by building some more power generators. Hopefully that's going to resolve it for him. Indeed, it will go partway to doing just that. However, Uzling is actually managing to continue in a power-inhabited world with power flowing through all of his stuff, which is
until
lovely.
Whoa, what? He didn't stall. He stopped at plus one.
That's an improvement from last time. If I can recall, he did power stall last time hard, didn't
yes.
he?
Yes. Very hard. Although, is he building an air factory? I can see second land, I think.
I don't think he's got an air factory planned quite yet.
The power generator configuration does look like one, though. Coding Squirrel, on the other hand, is going for air. I think I saw him start an air factory down there before you went away. Yes.
Indeed, there is an air factory there. So he is going to have the earlier air dominance. Oh, and wow, that's a significant amount of land factories that have just been planned.
You can feed a lot of land factories with the amount of mechs on this map. Like I said, it can potentially devolve into the biggest spam fest you have ever seen in your life. Mm-hmm. Because if you just continually build T1 factories and you force your opponent back to where they can't really regain their footing, it's possible to win this on the T1 phase very, very easily, if you can just get in there quickly enough to overpower your opponent.
Yeah, so do you expect any cheese? Do you expect any naval sort of presence? I mean, a substantial naval presence? I mean, that could be cool, couldn't it? I mean, I'm all up
Anything
for some
Anything
cool
can
games.
Happen. Twin Rivers, a lot of the games are pretty predictable, but with that amount of mass extractors and being able to, later on in the game, kind of sort of wall yourself off and prevent advancement, you can see some crazy stuff. I mean, early T4 rushes, the naval push that we talked about earlier, anything like that. Pretty much everything's on the table. You got the mass to do what you want. You just have to decide on a plan and carry it out.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so we're going to see a bomber and an air scout. Quite an interesting, nice little combo. Bomber going to potentially get some engineers if it can see them. That would be a fairly juicy target. An assault bot and two engineers. That's very, very juicy. And he's missing out.
Oh. Real quick note, did we ever decide, is this the best down of three on three different maps?
I think so. I think it is. Yes. I'm gonna say executively. Well, not executively, but I'm going to presume then. Yes, it is. I think it's three different maps.
Okay.
I think it was the same map over and over again, and that would get a little bit boring.
There goes is that a mantis or a hunter? I cannot see. On the left side, running around the back side. Mantis.
Mantis.
Going to go after that engineer and then possibly knock out those mass extractors, but I would imagine he's probably going to try to run around to the back and do more damage.
I think I've highlighted it a lot. I really think that people should go for engineers. I think that is the most important currency in the early game, engineers. Without a doubt.
Yeah. Although he is going to park. He's going to park and try to kill that mass extractor. If you look in the back of the map, there's a plateau back there with only one access ramp. And I wish he would have shot that mantis down there, because he could have easily killed those two engineers and stopped that expansion, stopped the hydro, stopped the land factory. But he's just going to sit there, take the hits, try and fail to kill a T1 mass extractor and lose that mantis.
Yeah. Absolutely. So. I still maintain, without a doubt, that engineers are more valuable targets than a three-quarters damaged mass extractor, because a three-quarters damaged mass extractor, it's not worth much. It's nothing.
Nope. If he can follow it up with a T1 bomber, he may be able to kill it off. It looks like there's also a little bit of damage being done in the north expansion. I see a tank sitting back in there.
Oh, yep. Up here.
Killed off that engineer and prevented that expansion there.
That is going to be a little bit of a bummer. Obviously, you know, Cybran relies on spreading their mass extractors far and wide. He's got an attack bomber just chilling over there for some reason. Perhaps he's waiting on a little bit more intel to dispatch that dude.
That doesn't even have a kill yet. That's the one that came in early in the game. He went to all the trouble of early air and building an early bomber. And now it has no kills, half health, just kind of sitting in the back of the map.
that seems ridiculous. UU for the win. Hello, welcome to the stream. We're doing a noob tournament sort of cast. It's going pretty well. Had some pretty awesome stuff. And this is the first of the best of three in the finals. Now, anti-air charging in at the front of the pack. That's going to soak up some of the heat, but it's also probably... you know, the most likely to get killed, although, I don't know, might just get away. No, he's going to lose, he's going to lose one anti-air. So I think that was a unit that he could probably have avoided losing. However, how do you see the spread of the Cybran player? I mean, UEF player looks like he's... spreading
UEF
much
has
better.
Solid expansion.
Yeah.
It's very nice looking. Usling is not sure. He must have, he does. He has T2 mass extractors because he's on somewhat level footing with Coding Squirrel. Mm-hmm. Does he? Mm-hmm. Nope. I was saying that wrong. Are those all T1?
Usling has Tech 2 mass extractors. He's got some Tech 2 mass extractors.
Yeah.
Which is what's allowing him to sort of keep up to pace, which is
because he's missing six mass extractors on his back expansion, which is really, really odd. I don't know why he isn't pushing towards the back.
That doesn't make sense. I mean, I suppose that bomber being parked up there is all right, I guess. Can snipe off an engineer if an engineer
can hit Usling's view and see if he actually has intel up there. I don't think that he does.
He doesn't. Just out of range, like.
So for all he knows, that's empty.
Yeah.
And he could send a bomber up there, send an engineer up there, no problem.
Yeah, just out of range, impressive indeed. But we can have a look at Usling's economy. He was very complacent about his mass in the last game. which was not something that we would like to see repeated, you know, hopefully, if we had our ideal sort of scenario. Units are going to get wiped out here.
It does look like he is repeating his mistakes, though, because he has the same eco, roughly, as Coding Swirl. He has less than half the factories. He is about to overflow mass. He's plus 22 with full storage, plus 10 now. It's the same mistakes that we were seeing last game are coming through this game. He loves teching up mass extractors. He's reasonably good at holding map control, but he just does not implement his mass very well at all.
No, I think that's, you know, that's a completely legitimate criticism.
I mean, a really weird mistake to see a 1300 rated player making. Like, I don't know if he wastes mass that consistently. I don't know how he got to that rank level. It doesn't
make sense. I mean, you know, we've been overflowing in mass the last 10 seconds. And, you know, that's a 20-21, overflowing mass by 21, whereas Coding is just not. I mean, I just don't see why it's happening, because it totally shouldn't be happening.
I do like the little push on the left side, though. Usling is drawing units away from the main offensive, moving around the back, going to try to kill off some mass extractors. Like I said, his command of the map is reasonably good, and for the units that he has, he's putting them to good use. He just doesn't have as many units as he could. Mm-hmm. He could have so much more, but he just doesn't use what he has.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Also, power is a problem. He's on 400 income versus 790 for the other player.
Yep, so he's power stalling, and he has probably way too mass. Way too much mass.
I think we have here an example of a player that has a really firm grasp on, like, the strategy of unit movement. Yep. Maybe not a really firm grasp, a good grasp of unit movement. But he has no idea how to make the economy work.
Yep. I completely agree with you. It's important to note that this bomber did actually get a kill. It did prevent an engineer from going up there and building any of those
nice
mass extractors.
So very nice.
I suppose it was worth it, but I feel it would have been more effective if it was actually doing stuff. But hey ho. I don't know. I think maybe Usling thinks that he can just sort of turtle by just upgrading his mass extractors. I mean, that's what he has done for some of them. I mean, tech 2 mass extractors already. I mean, that's fairly impressive. You know, 3 tech 2 mass extractors. He hasn't even gone over here, though. I mean, we're really starting to see Coding just advance.
You can see what I was talking about with the spam war. Because, I mean, it's almost entirely... It is entirely T1 units. They're all pushing their way forwards. And Usling just does not have enough units to compensate. He's going to get overrun.
Yeah. I honestly don't see that there is any other conclusion to this game. I mean, it was a greedy, greedy play by Usling to try and, you know, go for the upgrade on the mass extractors.
Mm-hmm. You know, I actually do think... I think I do know what's happening here. I would bet that Usling has played almost entirely team games before now, and he's used to leaning on other people for power overflow, so he doesn't have to worry about managing his own power. And he's used to immediately teching up, going for fire bases, going for experimentals, that kind of thing, where you see that type of thing in a team game. And he's dropped into 1v1, and he has no idea how to manage a single base economy, where you don't have anybody to fall back on, you don't have someone to gift you mass if you need it, you don't have projects to pour mass into provided by other people. I think that's probably what is going on here, if I had to lay bets on it.
Yeah, no, I think that's probably fair enough. And now we're just gonna see Coding's army just gonna wipe the floor with these mexes. It's just, it's a real shame. I mean, he has one, you know, Usling has one main army that's being crushed by Coding. I really don't think that there is any coming back from this point. I have no idea.
If either one of them were going to come back, it would be Usling.
It would be.
Because he has his economy centralized in the main base.
That is correct. He has those upgraded tier 2 mexes, and he's not overflowing mass anymore.
Even though he's lost two expansions, he isn't that far behind in eco, but it's going to be harder and harder to move forward from this point because he's just getting swarmed.
He does have tech.
That's all there is to it.
He has tech to air?
Yeah.
What?
That's kind of interesting. The Renegades are going to be useful versus the T1 spam because they're the only gunship with area of effect. But as soon as Coding Squirrel gets a T2 HQ online, he's going to push out a couple of mobile flak, and those gunships are going to be useless.
Exactly. Exactly. Important to note that Gorton is saying in the chat, there's almost no air presence by either player, and that is, you know, a fault that could probably be leveled at both of them.
I have to point out the background on that comment. Gorton will correct me if I assume wrong, but I think what he's saying is if he dies to air, he's going to say, oh, where's the air support? And it's a one versus one because he's used to playing in a team game.
Okay, so. Okay. But no, but actually,
still,
looking at it, there's almost no air. I mean, it's crazy.
He's got two interceptors and three gunships, and that's it. And the other player doesn't even have enough interceptors to kill off the gunships.
Four interceptors, one
six.
Scout? Six interceptors, seven interceptors, two scouts. That's crazy.
It's actually kind of hilarious. And his base is now...
ruined.
Yeah. That's... I think that's going to be GG. He's got a lethal amount of tanks closing in on his ACU.
Yep.
No units left. His base getting raided...
What a shame.
He may not die in this wave, but he's not going to come back from this wave.
He can't come back. He doesn't have anything. Coding is just determined to destroy all of this build power, and you know what? That's fair enough. That is absolutely fair enough. Any air support coming in? Yep, looks like we're finally going to see some interceptors engage the gunships. That'll distract them, I suppose. It'll do a little bit of damage here and there, but it's not gonna stop the onslaught, is it? It's not gonna stop anything.
Nope. I like on the outside edges, Coding Squirrel, even though he's already ahead on the middle, he's not taking anything for granted, and he's grabbing both side expansions. That's gonna give him four extra mechs on each side.
Yeah.
The islands on the outside corners of the map.
Yep. I mean, look at this. Look at this.
Yeah. Look at the map control.
Ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. You just can't expect to come back from that. Tier 2 air factory, it's not even building anything at the moment, really, is it? It's... no. Not at all.
People are asking how many kills are on the gunships.
How many kills are on
probably
the gunships?
Probably a lot. 12,
12, 14, and 24. Wow.
Dang, that's a lot.
That is a lot. So, I don't really... That's not a permanent strategy to the problem, though. Because, I mean, we're seeing anti-air coming out now. You know, we're seeing interceptors. Though these gunships aren't going to be around for much longer. Let's face it. You know, two were taken out in the space of about 2 seconds there. Doing a bit of damage, it's not going to change much, is it? It's not going to change much at all.
No, it's not. Not at all. Gorton saying, the game was over from minute three. And I kind of have to agree... because right off the bat, Coding Squirrel was in the back of Usling's base.
Yep.
And he had the raiding units in the right places. He was expanding properly much more quickly than Usling was, and it was just a downhill slide from there. I'd be interested to see... Usling did significantly better on choke point maps.
He did.
I'm interested to see what the second map is on this one, because he may have a little bit better chance on something that's not just completely open territory.
I think that, you know, that was something that he suffered from. I mean, open territory really doesn't aid the Cybran player actually at all. All right, what's going up next?
Well, it would if he was using his units correctly. It didn't help this particular Cybran player at all.
Okay, what is going on? Looks like Coding is in the next game. Okay. We do this one. I got to win two. Coding Squirrel. Okay, that's great. Normal format. Fuga. What? Time limit. Okay, for the final. Alright, great. Great. let's go and see if we can jump into this one. Probably won't be able to. We'll probably have to banter for like 2 minutes or something.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time.
Apologies for that, if that's the case. Nope. It's not looking good.
I reckon not.
No, we can. That's all right. Let's go and have a look at the standings right now. There has been no update on the standings as of yet. It's all looking rather similar to what it was.
Just do Sirius and watch them both die to point defense in the middle. That would be hilarious.
I have no idea what that is, but point defense in the middle, killing people, sounds amazing. Sounds really, really, really fun. All right.
Why have I not heard this before? Carbon-based Gap of Rohan. One does not simply walk into Supcom door. That is amazing. And Gap of Rohan is a terrible idea.
All right. Let's boot up. Let's try now. It's been round about 5 minutes. I'm very, very eager to play this game. I want to find out how it is resolved. I really do want to find out how this series ends. Okay. Nope.
There is nothing. There's a gap of wonder that's been made. I don't think there's been a gap of Seton's map. That would be really terrible.
A what?
A gap of Seton's. There's this like fad because Gap of Rohan is universally loved by Turtle players and universally hated by everyone else. So I don't know if it's a conscious running joke or if it's just something people did to be funny or what it is. But anyway, the map Wonder, someone overlaid Gap on top of Wonder. So it has the starting positions of Wonder, but the gap in the middle. And it's one of the dumbest maps that I've ever seen. And now there's people in chat talking about wanting to make a gap of Seton's, which would just be atrocious.
Oh. Things are going. We're launching right now. Oh, man. I feel that... wow. Okay, I don't think I've ever seen this map before.
This would be Syrtis Major. Wow. The map that they were talking about. There are point defense in the middle. There's actually a quantum gateway. Tremendous amount of reclaim in the middle. If you can get to that and kill it and reclaim it, that is a ton of mass injected into your early economy. And this is a pretty large map that you're going to see drops on a fair bit because the expansion is hard. You can kind of see the walkways, all the little channels running around the map where you're able to step. So since everything's kind of cut off a little bit from other areas, you can get some really interesting drops and bombs and raids into different places where it's hard to react to.
This is, again, something else that I would say favors the Cybran. You know, there's a lot of little expansions that the Cybran is going to enjoy investigating. And, you know...
If by investigating you mean shanking engineers, then yes.
I think that, you know, I mean exactly that. You know, I think the Cybran is going to exploit the UEF player.
And... Slowlord, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Slowlord commenting in chat, capture gate for the win. I have seen one game where someone captured the Quantum Gateway and actually started making support commanders out of it, and it was one of the funniest things I've ever seen. But I doubt it's going to happen in a 1v1.
Well, in all honesty, the rivalry between these two guys and the silliness that was pulled off in the first game, I would expect nothing less than a capturing of the Quantum Gateway. I'll be honest with you. I would expect nothing less.
If anybody gets it, I'm betting on Coding Squirrel.
You reckon?
I think so.
I'm betting on Uzzling. You know, he's a crafty, devious chap. He is a crafty, devious chap, and I would not put anything past him as far as I'm concerned.
He did better on the map with convoluted walkways and choke points. So in that regard, I think Uzzling's going to have a better chance on this map, but at the same time, there is a lot of ground to cover, and Uzzling seems to be a very centralized player. He's not very good at expanding. And if Coding Squirrel expands, he's going to end up with triple the economy of Uzzling easily, and he's just going to overrun him. I think In all honesty, judging from the past play that we've seen, Coding Squirrel's going to run with this one.
Totally. Judging from past plays, I think, you know, the fact that Coding Squirrel effectively has won two out of the past three games that were played, I think that it's highly likely that he takes the third one, in all honesty. But you know what? You got to root for the underdog, man. You got to root for the underdog.
If you say so.
I do say so. I'm just gonna
maybe that's the defining difference between an optimist and a realist.
You know what? You know, they say that a pessimist is... No, they say an optimist is just a badly informed pessimist. That's right. Just like my hindsight is 20/20, I feel fairly philosophical whenever I say it. Oh, look at this power spam.
So many power. And so many less power.
So many regrets, too.
Edmund on the chat saying, Cybern love on this map is true. Stealthed T2 transport drops. That is a very interesting point and could be kind of hilarious if it were to take place. If you put a Deceiver on a T2 transport, it stealths the transport and all of the units on it. So you can fly across the map free of the shackles of radar coverage and drop wherever you very well please. So that can lead to some pretty hilarious circumstances.
That seems like a tactic that Usling would actually use. Like, I don't know much about him, but it seems like he would do something like that, if I'm honest.
This is one of the reasons I love Cybern so much. They're not the sturdiest faction. They do have some glaring weaknesses, but if you want backstabby, sneaky play, Cybern is the way to go because you've got the stealth, the fire beetles, the tricky TAC missiles, all these unique tools in their quiver, and it makes for really interesting play. The flip side of that is some games you're going to win with overwhelming force and other games you're going to lose horrendously. It just depends on whether or not your cheese works.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know me. I love my cheese. Cheese is phenomenal.
Cheese is tasty.
Cheese is tasty. Six kills on that bomber.
Beautiful.
Six kills. I didn't manage to see which units that it managed to kill, but that's six kills.
Engineers.
Impressive. Exactly.
I believe the power spam has been halted because all those engineers got sniped off.
Oh no,
there goes laying down again.
Speak of the devil. And there it is. I'm just gonna take this very, very last opportunity to say, you know, thanks for tuning in, everybody. We really, really appreciate it. We've had a blast. It's been really, really good fun. If you're interested in following, I'll be doing more of my usual stuff on here. It's not just Supreme Commander. If you're interested in subscribing to Brink on his YouTube channel or on my YouTube channel, then that would be pretty awesome of you. And if you want to make a donation to help us do more of this sort of stuff, then please, that would be amazing if you could do that too. We got a donation tonight and we really, really appreciate it. But yeah, it would be awesome if you could do that. So just, you know, thanks for tuning in, everybody. It's been great. It's been really, really great.
I do love how Coding Squirrel has basically won the last two games because Usling screwed over his early build for power. So apparently Coding Squirrel decided that he needed to help him power stall more. So he's sending across that bomber to kill off the engineers building power.
Oh, man. Yeah. I mean, how is everybody's power and resources doing? I mean... Okay, Coding Squirrel is doing all right. And what? What is this? Usling has...
There's no power stall.
Usling has negative mass? Negative mass? Not overflowing mass? Is this...
I think Coding Squirrel needs to throw in the GG because if Usling fixed his econ... No, I'm just kidding. Honestly, at this moment, what I was afraid of happening is happening. Coding Squirrel is expanding ferociously, and Usling is not. And you can see the economy difference up there in the top right corner. It is definitely showing.
It is. And it is impressive. What we've already seen, it's crazy. It's crazy, and it will only continue to get crazier as the game goes on, and I think the difference will become more and more pronounced.
It's interesting that nobody went for the middle, like, at all. There's no artillery to try to kill the point defense, no ACE presence, nothing. They're just kind of abandoning it for some point later in the game.
Yeah. Well, perhaps that could be looked at as an opportunity. Perhaps somebody is serious about capturing that quantum gateway. You never know.
I would be incredibly entertained if Coding Squirrel decides to play this game out and like drag it and try to actually capture the Quantum Gateway.
Hey, you
It
never
would kind
know.
of make my day. It would be kind of a jerk move to not just straight up kill the other guy, but at the same time, the entertainment value would be amazing.
I am all about the entertainment value. That is for sure. This radar is also something that could be of use. We've got some
It could be
artillery.
captured, yes.
We've got some artillery that's coming down. Gonna do a little bit of damage to that point defense, of course. Uncontested, it's just gonna whittle away at it eventually and gain access to this middle area. Pretty freaking sweet. Okay, so nothing remarkable has happened. I mean, the map control is roughly 50-50. It looks like coding is a little bit more established when it comes to
Yeah, I was about to
building up
say,
mass extractors. That's
looking at the
about it.
color spread, it's 50-50, but Usling just does not have his expansions captured. You can
No.
see he's still got four empty mass extractors up there that Coding has on his side of the map,
Yeah.
and then the entirety of Coding Squirrel's left half is full,
Yeah.
and Usling has barely touched his expansions on the right side. So just strictly based on map control, this is going south very quickly for him. But he does have a jester.
That's gonna save him without a shadow of a doubt. It's gonna save his bacon.
Jester snipe for the win.
Jester Snipe FTW, for sure. Have we seen any tier 2 yet? I'm not entirely sure that we have. I
No.
don't think so. I really
Not
don't
on the
think we
map. It would
have.
be pretty early for it to be out quite yet.
Understandable.
Coding
Understandable.
Squirrel is getting up to where he has the eco to support it. But when you're making such great progress on T1, why would you move to T2?
Exactly. I mean, keep that aggression up. Seeing a little bit of a mass stall, I don't think that is going to last long, but it has a potential to. You never know. All right. How is Coding Squirrel doing in terms of economy? He's doing perfectly. He really is.
4,000 reclaim, balanced resources, 42 income. Yes.
Yeah, and it looks like indeed the Quantum Gateway is going to be destroyed. I'm not going to lie, I'm a little bit disappointed. I still think that that would have been a pretty sweet deal to capture. But hey ho, it's going to probably offer an absolute ton of mass. Indeed it does. 1,929.
Well, decreasing as the arty shots rain in. That's one thing you got to be careful of. You can actually damage wrecks. So if the arty keeps pounding away on that position, you're going to decrease the mass value.
Oh, well, why? Look at this. Now it is Coding's turn to overflow. This is wasted mass right now.
Needs to
Don't
leave that one alone.
take that, buddy. You don't want to be you don't want to be doing that. You really don't want to be doing that. Please no. Why would what a waste. What a waste. Like literally that entire I suppose it's not much of a waste if you consider it to be a denial of that mass to your opponent, but at the same time
There's nothing near
it's
it.
still a waste. Exactly.
It
Exactly.
wasn't in any danger whatsoever.
Exactly. There was no chance of a contest a contest between there was no chance of it being contested. Not at all. Oh
I
well.
think we're watching another train wreck of a game.
I think we are. I mean, already on 7,000 HP. I don't even think it's that's important. I just think it's the fact that,
There's a nice
Usling.
little push on the bottom, but I don't think that's really going to go anywhere fast enough to make a difference.
I think it's gonna do well. I just don't think it's gonna do, well enough to actually make a difference, exactly.
Yeah, there's still enough units streaming in from the left that it's just going to be a moot point.
I would think that that's probably the case. I mean, Coding's got the economy to support a continual stream of units. Usling has also got an economy to support a continual stream of units. However, his continual stream of units is somewhat less impressive than Coding Squirrels. Although, it's going to make headway, but wherever it gets to, it's not really going to do
Slower
much
and slower
damage.
as it goes, meeting more resistance.
I mean, theoretically, if it managed to get up here, there's a Tech 1-point defense that would engage the units over
Yeah,
there.
it's
There's
entirely Mantis. There's only a couple of Medusas.
exactly. There's a Tech 1-point defense over here as well. So, I'm not that hopeful. I'll be honest. I'm not that hopeful.
I think second place in this tournament might benefit from the Zoc lessons.
I think so. I think so.
Especially, Coding Squirrel seems to have a pretty good grasp on how everything works. Of course, anybody can benefit from a little bit of help. I think Usling definitely needs a little bit of assistance with his one versus one game.
Well, what's so infuriating is the fact that, wow, this is a nice snipe off of the hydrocarbon plant there. You know, let's
sitting on the edge of the cliff there.
Yeah, it's very, very nice. There's no response from Coding as of yet, and it looks like he's probably going to get it. Yeah, if he continues to focus it down, then he's going to get it. I think it's a case of being so far but so close. You know what I mean? Usling has come so far, but at the same time, he just hasn't got those fundamental principles of don't overflow your mass ever.
He has lucky moments and some key placement of units that works for him. Overall, it's just a little bit too much of a weakness in a couple too many areas.
Yeah.
And it's just not, it's not all coming together for him.
Yeah, I completely understand. You know, he's just missing the fundamental principle of doing that. Oh well. You know what? You live and you learn. I'm sure that that in the future he'll come back a stronger player, and you know, we could perhaps see him in future tournaments. For sure.
This is probably one of the more accessible tournaments for anybody who wants to play in it. I mean, under 1,000 ladder rank grabs a huge swath of players.
Yeah, totally.
So, I mean, you just got to get in on time. The cap this time was 32. I'm not sure what the cap will be next time. But basically, you just got to get in. If you don't compete, you can't win. And if you do compete, you will always learn something, as long as you hit it with an open mind. So I don't really see any reason not to jump in one of these tournaments.
Wait a minute. What is Coding? Coding Squirrel is saying that he's tabbed out to specifically talk in our chat. Why?
I think that's actually cheating, because if you're in the chat, you can see what's going on
from five minutes ago.
But
that's just
I think we can confidently say that he's probably won it, because if he could lose that much focus that confidently, then
I don't know, there's being discussion of a disqualification. Seriously, I mean, you know, you never know.
That depends on whether you think information from 5.5 minutes ago is useful or not.
I would debate its usefulness. I mean, Coding Squirrel, he pretty much knows what's on. You know, nothing's really changed. I mean, look at this. Look at this Air Scout. That's going to find out everything else that he doesn't know. Everything else that he doesn't know, he found out with that Air Scout. So now there's pretty much nothing that Coding doesn't really know about. Hey-ho. Hey-ho. That's just the way of things. I love how, you know, this entire army that Coding Squirrel sent up here just completely bypassed the ACU. Like, it wasn't even interested in even damaging it. It was just like, let's go
Why
past
kill
this dude.
When you can humiliate?
Exactly.
No, that's the whole thing that I've talked about a couple times now. If you can't decisively kill the ACU with a single group of units, attack something important, because it prevents a comeback later on and you're not donating the mass. So, really, he's playing the game cautiously and effectively, not taking any risks, even though he does objectively have the overwhelming advantage.
Oh, yeah.
To prevent a drastic turnaround or some kind of luck shot, sometimes it's still very, very useful to play the game this way, just to prevent anything dumb from happening.
Oh, totally. I would completely agree. if you can't kill the ACU straight away, then just don't even bother trying, you know? I mean, you can do much more interesting economic or build power damages, which will probably be more effective than even wasting your ammo on the ACU. But anyway, we see a Tier 2 air factory, which looks like it's going to be building the What is it going to be building? Tier 2?
Corsairs.
Corsairs, okay.
T2 fighter bomber, which is absolutely an exercise in futility because there are 25 interceptors hovering around over the top of the factory. So,
Not great. Not great.
Not great.
Yeah. And the ACU is just all alone up here? That makes no sense, I suppose. Considering all of the defense is around here, and all of the defense is pretty much nothing, I suppose.
Yup. If I were you, I would probably hit the plus speed button a couple of times, because they're probably wrapping up on this game. We might be able to... Oh yeah, it's going off. Okay.
I suck at land spam maps, always have. Well, you know what? Practice makes perfect, buddy, and I'm sure you'll return bigger and better in the future. That's for absolutely sure. Let's stick it into 8x speed.
There's a couple of Corsairs in the back there, but I don't think they're going to do much good. T1 bombers coming in, knocking out engineers, power, and Corsairs are headed around the south side of the map, but there's enough interceptors. Yep, going to wipe them out. Yep. No problem whatsoever.
Yep, GG. GG. Lubikes, thank you very, very much for following. I really appreciate it. Yep, there we go. GG. GG. And with that...
That is the final GG.
Oh, the final GG.
Coding Squirrel is the reigning champion of the noob tourney.
Congratulations, Coding Squirrel, for being successful. Hopefully you haven't minded that your games were casted by one professional and one crappy FAF player, Tony Buer.
I really wish you would stop using the term professional because it does not fit me.
Well, I think, you know, perspective is a good way to look at life, and you're a professional in comparison to me. There's no denying that. It's great. Zlo saying Coding Squirrel won, but he's still a noob. Well, I suppose technically you did win the noob tournament, but I think this is
relatively speaking, he's the least noob.
He's the least noob of the noobs. He's the king of the noobs for sure, for sure. Oh, man.
All right. I think that's going to wrap it up for the tournament, isn't it? That's about all we have to cover.
That's all we have. Check out the videos that we're going to be putting out on Monday. Very, very interesting videos that we've got coming out on Monday, don't we? Got really, really cool ones.
Yes. Side by side. When they come out on the channels, whichever one you subscribe to, whether it's Potato or mine, there's a link in both the descriptions to the other one. So definitely check those out.
Yeah, awesome. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very, very much for watching. Myself and Brink both really appreciate it. Tune in next time. Hopefully we'll do this more in the future.
With fewer technical difficulties.
Fewer technical difficulties, exactly. I appreciate it. I appreciate all of the love that you guys have shown me tonight. It has been fantastic. And I think it was really, really great. But anyway... Thanks for watching. My name's Norbert Potato. Been joined by Brink of Insanity. And we will see you next time. Bye.
See ya.